I'd like to bring the Conservation Commission meeting to order. It's now being 7 o'clock, and the first item on the agenda is an Eagle Scout project. It's in the town forest under the townwide public trails maintenance. It's 27-0568, and we have the Eagle Scout here to make his presentation on this project.
Hi, my name is Nick Smith from the Group 702. I'm the Life Scout looking for an Eagle. My Eagle project is going to be walking in from Wood End. We are going, and then you can either break off on the Yellow Trail, but mine is planning on extending the boardwalk or just moving it past the wetland so it'll make a better transition to the town forest trails. There's the location. It's nearby the council ring. I don't know if any of you guys know where that is. But yeah, it's right near there going in, so it'll be a, you know, a better transition, and I think people enjoy it more. Yeah, it's improved access from Wood End into the council ring. It'll the beneficiary, he kind of suggested that we it doesn't have to be my project, but the other kid who's coming in may do the first and last parts if I do the wetland, just to connect them for the cross-country skiers and mountain bikers, or I start coming from the boardwalk and just extend the boardwalk 40 feet. Here are some pictures of it, and it's you can see it's in pretty rough shape, in desperate need of attention. So yeah, I think it'll be a good project. And then here's the basically the print of the suggested project. So we'll bring it in here and extend it throughout the wetland, or we'll start it at the wetland and extend it 40 feet in, and then TJ, 3 months later, 6 months later, will come in and put the intro part there. But our beneficiary wants it to be completed, a complete extension from the boardwalk. They'll be allowing clearance for it as well. I think 6 inches, so the animals can run through the, go through the bottom, and you can't really see the measurements, but they're all approximately 10 feet. So it'll be 40, and the total is 70 feet. So the other kid will come in 3 months later and extend it another 30. Are there any other questions?
We, Chuck Droney, myself, and Amy Shikitani took an inspection of the area on Monday afternoon and met Ian out there. We noticed that the end of the existing boardwalk going up towards the area that he wants to do that particular work, that first 10 feet or so seem to be quite dry, right past the tree, the large tree there. But after that, there seemed to be a lot of disruption in the wetland area, a lot of mucking around. I could see bike tire tracks and people walking. So I think there's somewhat of a benefit to put something over there so that you do stop some of that, you know, treading on the wetland area. I know that Chuck had said that one of the things that we would like to see that would be similar to Kirchian Woods, and it's the new design, is to put 2x4s on either side of the walkway to prevent anybody falling off to the side.
Yeah, we're going to add that into the new sketch.
Okay. Are there any questions from members of the commission?
So this is sort of a straightening of the path right, instead of it taking like a sharp left,
yeah,
90-degree left turn. And there's a, if you did take a sharp left and you went maybe, you know, a couple yards, you'd, there'd be another path that connects that higher ridge trail to the one that goes up to the circle, the pine forest.
Yeah.
And, you know, just looking at that, just wondering if, was there any discussion or any thought to potentially, you know, decommissioning that little section of the trail and letting it go back to forest, you know, to just sort of increase forest area and with the trail correction? Because I kind of see the project of what you're doing is like really correcting a problem area in the trail system, which is needed.
Yeah, we, as a troop, my project isn't geared toward that, but I know that it can happen. We just have to, someone else, or maybe as a troop or combination of the troops, we come in, rip out the current boardwalk, which isn't in very good shape. It's just basically the three planks strung together across, and it's not in very good shape. So we could look into that, but I mean, I can't promise anything, but I know that we can.
Did you call anybody on the Trails Committee?
I did.
Yeah.
Would you like to speak to that?
Yeah, sure. It,
just introduce yourself,
yeah,
for the sake
Will,
of the record.
Yeah, I'm Will Finch. I'm on the Trails Committee. And we did have a meeting. Ian was at one of our previous meetings, and we discussed this issue. I believe it did come up with the issue of abandoning that section of trail. And at least put some logs across there so it discourages people from using it. I'd like to go off and kind of point out where this is to other people. As you come across the existing boardwalk, yeah, it kind of ends here and takes a jog to the left, and then there's like a dogleg that goes back to this trail, which goes up to the council ring. And, you know, it's very logical to continue this trail. People have been using it ever since we tried to stop people from using it. There was actually some boards, like a fence across the end of the boardwalk to send people up the hill or to take that jog. But it really wasn't the fact that people were tearing the boards down and going straight anyways. And especially when you're skiing, you're coming down a hill and you want to just keep going straight and out onto the boardwalk anyways. And also, I would encourage Ian agree with the scheme to start his work where this boardwalk ends and get as far as he can. Because whenever you have an end of a boardwalk, you need at least an 8-foot transition to ramp down to the ground. And if that was done right at the end of this one and then start the boardwalk later, it's just a lot more work to ramp back up to it. And it would have to be torn out when it was eventually finished anyway, so I think it makes sense to start where this boardwalk ends. Now, this has been a long process. We've had a whole series of Boy Scouts that have been working on this project over the years, and it's been a huge improvement over what it was in the past. I'm really glad to see this work coming to fruition at this point. I do also agree that it'll lessen the impact on this wet area in here because, you know, all the dogs and people tromping through there and spreading mud all over it. It'll really, I think, improve the situation a lot.
So, I'm sorry, what was your name again?
Will Finch.
Well, thank you. The existing boardwalk that's there,
mm-hmm,
is a little bit uneven.
In places, it is and does need some repair or shoring up.
So one of the things we noticed in some of the spots was that there wasn't a 6-inch clearance today,
mm-hmm,
between the boardwalk and the ground. Is
right.
That because it, do you know if it, because it sank over time, or has it always been like
it's
that?
It's sunk over time. Some of the boardwalk is supported with cinder blocks,
yeah,
and that just hasn't proved to be a good system to use, and we've we either use a corrugated pipe, plastic pipe, that spreads the load out over a wider area, or other places you can actually bam a 4x4 into the ground until refusal, as far as you can get it in, and then bolt on cross pieces which then support the boardwalk structure. Either way, these systems have proven to be sturdy, long-lasting.
Okay.
They don't start sinking into the ground. Because the cinder blocks have a tendency to tip over. They're very hard to lock into place. So that is on our list of items from the Trails Committee point of view for repair work on parts of the existing boardwalk.
And are the scout projects usually have to be is it a building oriented project, or can it be? So one of the things we would obviously like to see, and the trails are pretty well laid out today, but the ideal scenario is you have a trail go in a way that actually doesn't go through the wetlands. So instead of having to build a bridge, you just go around the wetlands. Now it looks like from the map there, in order to get from Dividends Island to the Council Ring, there's no other way to get across.
Yeah, you'd have to cut down even more trees, and even then the wetlands are pretty extensive, so I don't know if you'd either have to cut another trail or just keep using.
That was my sense as well.
Yeah.
But I mean, is it possible, not necessarily for your project, but down the road for somebody to do sort of a survey and find ways to, in general, minimize the impact on the wetlands? Could that be a project in itself, or is that different from what your mission is usually?
I think the Eagle Scout projects usually have to help the community. I mean, one guy I know that he's helping with the landscaping at the church. I mean, that's not really... It's helping the landscaping, but it's not building a bridge. I think it's anything that really helps the community. So if it helps the wetland, it can probably do it.
Okay, all right.
I just have one more comment on that section of trail that we'd like to abandon. That does go through a wet area, and so we'd be, that would be reverting to its natural state. So that would be a plus for this project.
Any other questions from the commission?
Oh, and one more thing, sorry. we had discussed, I think maybe with Anique or Chuck, actually putting a planting, some kind of plants where the abandoned trail is. I went to a trails convention, we're discussing trails system in Middlesex Fells, and whenever they really want to abandon a trail, they need to put in plants to just sort of disguise it partly, but also discourage people from using it. Otherwise, if you just pile some logs or things, they'll just tear it back out and start using the trail again, especially the bicyclists.
Sounds great. I guess one of my kind of final follow-up questions is that first section of plank, I've heard, maybe this was a conversation you and I had outside the meeting, I'm not sure, but I heard Will say that in order to kind of ramp up to a plank, it takes about 8 feet, and you had talked about, if this is upland area, maybe we could ramp down and then ramp up. But I'm thinking with the 8 feet needed, it doesn't sound like it makes sense. So I'm prone to approving the existing design as is.
Yeah. I think that's a good idea because it would be great if I could finish off the wetland, but it may come up 7 or 5 feet short because it's a 70-foot area, and when you're walking in, if you push this through two boards, 15 feet even, I may not even be able to reach the other set of logs on the other side. So I just assume it would be better if we connect them, my project connects them, and then another kid is coming in, and we're going to put a removable down part, I guess, so that people can go down it without hurting themselves, and TJ can come and remove it.
Any questions from the public? Yes.
I just had one comment. I'm Ian's father, John Castrina. But I'm also an adult volunteer with Troop 702, and just in case it wasn't clear, we're reasonably confident that TJ Kelly is available to complete the remainder of the section to essentially get it past that muddy area by year end.
Great.
So he is, the wheels are in motion, but it's obviously up to him to make it happen.
Becky, I just have a quick question, and Ian, great job presenting.
Thank you.
I think it's a good project. This goes under the townwide code of maintenance?
Townwide trails maintenance.
Okay. So what's the, what's the typical process for this? Is this
I was going to ask the same question.
Okay.
Make a vote on this, or is this just a presentation?
You don't need a vote. You can accept the project.
So I make a motion to accept the project.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Thank you.
Good work.
Thank you
for coming in.
Send you an approval letter.
I look forward to using that. My cross-country skis next year.
Let me know.
So you're going to ride a bike. I want to
go check it out.
All
right.
Yeah.
Get the funders started. We'll take some pictures while you're out there. Send those to us.
Okay. And then I can bring the one over here. Checking for sure.
All right. Thank you.
The next item on the agenda was a request for determination for 2016-790 Rustic Lane, and that's continued at the request of the applicant.
Right, so we'd like to get the engineer insert the townwide water and sewer in that spot, and the COC for Birch Meadow, which is Ryan. Priscilla's here from the engineering department, and it'd be nice,
okay.
Nice fit.
What was that again? I'm sorry.
So it would be the discussion on the townwide water and sewer extension,
okay.
To that existing permit, and the approval for the Birch Meadow lighting project, which was approved and closed at the last meeting. And we wrote the order of conditions and sent it out to the engineering department this afternoon, and the commission has also had it in their inbox, in their email. And I don't know if there's any comments, but those two things would work at this point.
First of all, yes, are there any comments on the, is it the order of conditions for Birch Meadow lighting?
Yeah.
Did you guys have an opportunity to review that?
I did. I sent it to everybody. I sent some just minor edits. I didn't see any context-wise, just some minor corrections that
don't change the context of anything?
Correct.
Right.
Okay. How about anybody else?
I read it. It's fine.
That's fine.
The only thing I saw in there, Chuck, I saw something about, and I think this is fine, the more the better, you know, and I think communication will be key. I saw it to have them contact you after each light pole is installed. Is that really what you want?
Well,
it seems like a lot.
We're approving the entire project,
mm-hmm.
which they only have funding for some of it.
Yep.
So I figured, let's keep in touch.
Yeah.
So they might do 5 this year, and in another year they might do, you know, 7 or 8, and I think that they should keep me aware of the project.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I don't think there's any limit to quantity, but I just want to make sure that they may get done, you know, start doing one a day. That I mean, and you can work that communication out.
Yeah, that's right. Engineering's out all the time checking projects, and so is conservation, so it's no big hassle if I'm there. We could look at a few. I don't think it would be, as soon as I get back to my desk, I have to jump up and go and see another one. I don't expect that's what's going to happen. So there's a couple things inside the permit. Most of it's standard boilerplate that we expect, you know, 72-hour notice before the project happens, the ability to review it.
but we were kind of working on a request that had a lot to do with getting an approval. Is that correct? And there's, so I asked for final plans to be submitted to the commission at that point where they're ready to go out for the bid. We're not approving those plans, but we're getting a copy to review.
I don't see it in here, and I'm just admittedly looking at it now, but is there something in the findings about the design of the lamps that they will shield light downward?
There's...
I mean, I don't know if that was... or is it at least referenced in the
it's
the
referenced
documents?
In the memos from George,
okay.
And
okay.
Those are in the
gotcha.
Document section.
Yep. Okay. Just want to make sure it's in there.
Yep.
All right. Any other questions? So we can sign that?
Yep.
So I guess while that's being passed around, Chris, are you here to talk about the extension
plan?
Ryan.
Sorry.
Ryan.
That's okay.
Apologize.
So I don't know if you're familiar with what the...
Could you introduce
my name is Ryan Percival. I'm with the engineering division.
Okay.
So we've had a permit for water and sewer, blanket order of conditions that basically covers all the maintenance that we work within our roadways and within the buffer areas. That generally, 95% of the time, we're in the roadway, and it's just areas where we're abutting a wetland area. So that's what this order of conditions is for. Anytime that we go into an easement or a wetland area, we would come and file a notice. So, and we've done that with the Birch Meadow, not the Birch Meadow, I'm sorry, the Ivy Lane and Belmont Street loop that we just completed.
Mm-hmm.
We filed a notice for that. And we would file notices for anything that happens within a resource area. So this, generally speaking, is just for us to do our work in our roadways where we abut a buffer zone. And it's just an extension of our existing permit.
Any questions for the commission?
I guess my question more towards Chuck, have you seen the order of conditions from
I have. Then? I read through the order of conditions and I sent out something to the commission, just kind of that I reviewed it and I called it a buffer zone project. I thought what was originally written in 2001 still works today with this project, and any time that the DPW or engineering needs to do work in the resource area or the stream or the water or when we're they always file a separate permit for that.
Yeah, I remember that.
So I did do that. I don't know if you saw it. It's this front page here.
So are we to sign that extension?
Right. So, you know, luckily we have a meeting tonight because it actually expires tonight. So I prepared this, and it would be nice to have it signed, because if we don't, we learned on our last townwide project that the DEP is not allowing these conditions to be written the same way, where we're allowing work without understanding how much impact it's doing, various size and length and square foot. And they're asking for us to determine that prior to doing these townwide permits now, which is really hard to do. And this is a better way to do it, which is to write various. And they don't accept that anymore. So I would like to keep this permit going.
Even when they have to file a notice of intent?
No. Just on the townwide permit for ongoing maintenance throughout the town for, you know, resource area work. And that's what we gave up on the last permit. And we had to take all that work that was allowed in the first 5 feet of the resource area, had to be taken out, and now we have to file for that in the town. But the old permit allowed it, and this commission allowed it for, I don't know, 7, 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
So.
So this would be an extension of this?
This would be an extension of a buffer zone permit. The one we lost out on was more of a resource work and riverfront work.
How long would we be extending?
You can only extend these for 3 years now. So it's we're extending it for 3 years.
Okay.
You know, at some point, you might say, look, I'd really like to review it and still also extend it. But we didn't have an opportunity to, and like, so I reviewed it. So that's really where we're at with this.
It says hereby extended until 2012. Date the order is last extended 2019. That is backwards.
Yeah, I meant, is that wrong? Is that wrong?
I'm not usually good with details.
Right.
Yeah, those are backwards. We can straighten that out.
Okay.
Did we sign the other page?
You want me to just...
No, let's... You can just continue. If you're... You can continue this at the end of the hearing, or I can just run down and switch those dates around so we can sign it. This is the page you have to sign.
Mm.
So I'd like to get those right.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's do that.
So let's wait.
Just wait till the end of the meeting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good
so
catch.
You don't need
Ryan
to...
Ryan doesn't have to stay.
For right.
Should I put this in front? You want to read this whole word? It's the order of conditions.
Oh, I remember that. That's what we sent out the other day. So you're all set, right, Ryan?
This is what I have here.
That has the order in it, if you wanted to read through it.
Oh,
any questions from the public?
I don't think I realized the letter was live.
Probably because it had no typos, right?
Hearing none.
Except April 17th.
Okay, we're ready for the next item on the agenda, which is the 720, a notice of intent 270-0659 for 56 Cross Street, map 12, lot 77, Armstrong. And the hearing for this, I just read the DEP number, is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Hearing will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant will present the proposal. The commission will receive reports, technical advisors, and other town departments. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant. An attendance sheet is being is in the back of the room to my left. At this time, with the members of the CONCOM, please introduce themselves, starting on my left. Chuck.
Chuck Tirone, Conservation Commission.
Harry Curtis.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Al Couillard.
Amy Shukatani.
Judy Rogers, Recording Secretary.
And we have Steve Erickson, Forest Environmental.
Thanks, Steve.
Good evening. I'm Stephen Erickson from Norris Environmental Services. This is a relatively simple project. We've got a couple of resource areas on site. We've got a perennial stream or riverfront running along the westerly side of the property. And coming toward the north and easterly side, we've got a bordering vegetated wetland. The riverfront is shown to you as flags 1 through 9B. And the vegetative wetland is the A series. What we're proposing is the construction of a porch in addition to the house, a deck and a breezeway in the back, and a reconstruction of the driveway on the side. The construction that's proposed will disturb 3,100 square feet of the property below the 5,000 minimum under the Rivers Protection Act. The entire lot is virtually flat. If you look at the topography on here, got an elevation of 102 over here, and we only go down to something like 98 here. So there's very little slope. It's all lawn. It's all taken care of. So the possibility of erosion is just about zero. We do have infiltration of the roof drains proposed in the front, in the side, and that will be some improvement on the existing conditions in the riverfront area.
corrected. Have we designated that as a river before? We're questioning that on our site visit.
Yeah, we talked about that. Jamie was surprised that it was a river.
One of the abutters had made an application a few years ago, and it was in a main stream, not a river.
Where was this?
Two houses to the left of this one. So I'm wondering, how'd you come up with that, Steve? Steve Stratz?
It's shown as perennial on the USGS topographic map, so it's presumed to be perennial. Not having any information to the contrary, we just treat it as perennial. But we can easily meet the performance standards of the riverfront anyhow, so it really didn't matter to us.
Okay.
Steve,
it's actually pretty substantial.
Yeah, it was going pretty good when we were there.
It's one of those rivers you could kayak, so.
Until you got to that concrete wall.
What?
Yeah, huh?
It takes a lot of nerve to go through the culvert.
Yeah.
Don't go. We'll meet you there with your kayak.
Only pops, really, after we make it.
All right.
Yeah. You have infiltration designed by others. What does that mean?
We're putting the infiltration trenches, we're putting it in the Caltech chambers, and they actually are sized for the water that's being taken there. But the surveyor didn't want to take responsibility for the design of that. If you want those calculations, I haven't included them in the notice of intent, but we could do that.
I think that would be appropriate.
Another question was, when we were on our site visit, the applicant had mentioned that he would add two additional Caltech chambers to the plan. I don't know, is he still interested in that?
Yeah.
In the opposite corners of the house?
What was the reasoning?
Huh?
What was the reasoning?
Just to
increase the amount of infiltration.
Increase the amount of infiltration, a little bit of mitigation, goodwill.
Oh, so that what was on the other side was not being piped into the chambers already?
No, the existing structure wasn't. Only the new construction was proposed to be piped.
So he's willing to put
the
whole
existing building in the addition.
Do it all out.
And that's okay with him, Chuck? I can't get your sign in the way.
Yes.
That's all right with you?
Yeah, that's all right.
All right,
yeah.
I just wanted to check.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what we talked about.
Yeah, okay.
We had a site visit on Monday, and we did notice that there was quite a bit of debris along the 1A series, and actually along the B series, and was hoping that you could remove, you know.
That was all done to the prior owners. We just bought the house in September, and we talked on the site visit on Sunday, and I've talked with Chuck about it, that they would come out and let me know what they want to clean up, and we would clean the whole area up.
Okay.
That's not a problem at all.
Okay, thank you. Any questions from the commission members?
I just have a quick, the plan is to fill the existing, because what I remember, the driveway slopes in.
Yes.
So fill it, and that's just going to be grassed area?
Grass.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, I like that design better.
Yeah, originally, when we were out for your trees, you were going to put the driveway on the other side, right?
Yeah.
Right, we're not going to be doing that.
Excuse me. I have a question about, so there's a shed in the backyard between the 25 and 35 foot buffer zone. Is that going to remain?
Yes, for now.
For now. And it's grass all the way around, though?
Yes.
It's probably grandfathered in, is my
thought. I don't think the floor actually touches the ground. It's sitting on
It's raised on cinder?
Yes, it's on.
Yeah.
Or
I think it has
chimney
posts.
Pipes. Chimney pipes and wood, I think.
Wood.
I have a question. Typically, when we have something with Caltech, you know, some sort of infiltration, there's usually O&M associated with that. I think we usually ask for
an operations and maintenance plan?
Correct.
It's just, I think it's boilerplate.
Yeah, it's a boilerplate, but
there isn't much to do. I mean, typically you leave it in an observation hole that's buried but near the surface. But if it overflows, in the event it does fail, it backs up to the gutters, and the gutters have a relief valve toward the surface. This area is all sand underneath, so the Caltech chambers are probably overkill to begin with, except in a very serious event, I don't think the water gets toward the river or the wetland.
No, I guess part of, I'd really like to see those cul-de-sac chamber specs. You know, just thinking about this, it's fairly, there isn't a substantial grade in the backyard, right? And the wetlands are, you know, elevation-wise, within 3 feet of the back deck. You know, I'm just, I guess I'm mostly curious what the design of those, what you can design in that limited amount of elevation.
My preference would be to go without it because I don't think it's necessary with the sandy surface that's there. But if the commission wants them.
I just want to say I think infiltration is good. I'm not necessarily, if you want to propose something else that is better fits the situation, you know, I'm not gonna tell you what to design. But if a cul-de-sac doesn't fit the bill, then I'd like to see the alternative.
If you think the infiltration is helpful, then we don't mind installing it. I would prefer not to install it. I don't think that it's really necessary because of the sand. And despite the units do end up costing money. You need a machine to dig the hole. You pay about $150 for the cul-de-sac unit, and you've got to plumb the thing together. So by the time you get through, you're paying $300 or so.
I think, I'm not sure I'm making myself clear. I think infiltration is good. I'd like to see infiltration. That's just my opinion. I'm not sure cul-de-sac is the only option for this situation. And, you know, if there are other options that better fit this type of yard and the type of infiltration that's needed, then that option should be provided.
Can I make a suggestion? How about going with Anika's thought? Instead of two additional cul-de-sacs, how about if we go with a 1 foot deep, 2 foot wide crushed stone drip trench along the on the left-hand side of the existing foundation and along the back of the house in the existing foundation to kind of take care of that side and leave the two chambers that are on the existing plan.
I think that
works.
That
seems reasonable.
I think that makes more sense than adding the two.
I believe it would like to see that and the specs for the cul-de-sac. So I believe...
To compare them side to side or to see
them
both?
It's just part
just
of
we want them,
the
I
application.
And I think the specs on the cul-de-sac will have an operation and maintenance plan just so the applicant knows what to do going forward. Nothing
so, Alan,
fancy.
Let me just ask you a question. You want a continuous drip trench around the house?
No.
Around that one side of the house?
I would go with the left side of the house where he's proposing to have the stairs and the door,
mm-hmm.
all along that side, and then halfway down the existing house, stopping at the new addition.
Is there gutters on the house now?
Yes. They go into the ground now, but I don't know what they really do.
Why does he need it between the downspouts?
Well, you're still gonna get water off the roof. Still gonna get some. I mean, you can take the gutters off. You want?
Is it a hip? It's a hip roof, right?
Hip roof.
Yep.
So if you on the westerly side, the surface area of the roof actually going off that side is not a lot, right?
Yeah, it's a small lot.
I guess I would just advocate, you know, to just let the applicant know like the intent of what we want to do and let them come up with a feasible way to solve that. I don't want to tell you guys what to do and then have you be stuck with something that really doesn't make sense.
No, but we'll look at those two options. And
but something that fits the bill of infiltration.
Yep. Yeah, that's fine.
Steve, why do you say that when you say this, it's all sand? Is that from experience in the area or is that from soil map?
It's because I'm a soil scientist and I look at it and I know what the soil is before I dig a hole. After about 40 years, it's not all that hard anymore.
So my reservation is the driveway is bigger than the addition, and that flows right out to the street and into the storm drain. So we're talking about infiltration off the house. Is the driveway going to slope towards the road?
The way it's shown, it's just about level. But
hard to tell from the plan.
What we can do is we can leave it a little bit toward the easterly side and put a trench along the side of the driveway instead of the cul-de-sac.
Well, why don't we encourage you to go and see how much infiltration you can eke out of this design and come back with some proposal.
Yeah, I'd hate to put the cul-de-sacs in where you don't need them.
Right.
In sandy soil and then have all the driveway run off down the storm drain into the stream. You know, so I mean, I think we can be flexible, find something that works.
I just don't want to continue the hearing and wait for another meeting,
yeah,
because we'll be putting it off for another month and we're coming into the construction season. So I'd rather the commission tell me that they can condition it with the option of putting, let's say, a trench drain along the driveway or the cul-de-sac units. I don't want to wait 2 weeks for what's a relatively minor detail and miss the construction season. We've got to get a contractor lined up. If you can't let him in there when you need the work done, then you lose that contractor, you get him held up another month. And it's just nice to expedite it. So if we have the option, and you can make it the order of conditions subject to approval of Mr. Tyrone or something along that line, then that would be fine. Then we can easily explore other options. But rather than continuing the hearing, I'd rather just say the cul-de-sacs are going to work fine. Why don't we just use them?
How? What's the shallowest cul-de-sac? Like the
18 inches.
Oh, and it has, but that has to be put like 2 feet above the water table, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So if it's 3 foot elevation between the wetlands and the back property addition, then you can't use a cul-de-sac.
I don't actually know what the water table is.
Unless you build up the, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I mean, if the water table is perfectly flat, and generally speaking, the water table is slightly, it can be slightly higher in the ground level flowing towards a stream. You know, I guess in terms of something that's such a substantial design, I would want to see it before approving this notice of intent.
Keeping the 18-inch cul-de-sac 2 feet above the water table wouldn't be any more difficult than keeping the a trench drain
trench
above the water table, 12-inch
well,
trench drain.
I'm not picking a one over the other. I'm just, you know, it's details like that that make me want to see the design before I vote on this notice of intent. That's the additional information I would like to see.
How do the other members feel?
I like the trench. I can live without the cul-de-sacs and just trench, personally.
I think I'm on the same page as Anika. You know, I think we're typically asking for these items. You know, I think...
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're typically asking for these items on most notice of intent. I mean, I would like to see it submitted with as part of the project. I mean, I think... As far as I see it, the infiltration, you know, that is one of the big items here, as far as protection of the wetlands going forward. So
let's talk about this plan as is,
mm-hmm.
with two cul-de-sacs and sandy material on the site. Is it adequate as it stands? Is that your assumption? Is that what you're saying?
That's what I prefer, so we can move ahead.
I guess what I'm saying, though, is with the design as is, just a little spot check of elevations, the only way he's going to be able to put those cul-de-sacs in is to raise the grade around those cul-de-sacs.
Why don't we do it this way? If we approve the plan as is, subject to verification of the water table, when we've got a machine out there to dig, if there's something wrong with the water table, if it's higher than we think, then we'll come in for an insignificant change or an amendment to the order of conditions.
If that's the way you want to proceed,
I'd just like to move forward.
I would
Chuck. Do you have any comments on this?
No, I mean there's a lot of options out there, and I'm sure Steve
yeah.
can find something that's going to work. I'd just like
a plan that shows everything when you're done, when you've decided on that, so we have that plan?
I'll verify the water table.
Yeah.
Ahead of time to make sure that the Caltech units are gonna be appropriate. And if we have to amend or insignificant change, then we come back to the commission, so that you know it is gonna work properly.
The one thing I would add to this conversation is that we don't have an order to sign tonight, so.
Yes.
We are coming back to the next meeting anyway, so if any of this can happen before now and the next meeting, that would be great.
I will try to do that.
Okay.
Okay.
So I'm still hung up on the driveway, because it literally is more square footage than the addition. And it looks from here, I'm guessing, like it drains right to the street, and so if we can address that as well.
I have a question. I don't know if you have the answer, Steve. Where does the drain go in the existing driveway? The driveway goes down and there's a gate across it and there's water going somewhere. Is that just a dry well?
Yeah, there's a drain at the bottom.
Is it right at the bottom, just a pit?
Just a dry well?
So it's just a dry well type unit, yeah.
Yeah.
So you got that's gonna be filled in and grassed over, so you're gonna gain that area.
That's infiltrating into the ground today, whereas the new driveway is gonna.
Well, that tells me that if the water table were high in that area, it would be going backwards and it'd be, the drain obviously would function.
I agree.
That's a good 3.5 feet.
We'd have water going into the garage.
That wall's a good 3.5 feet probably, so.
Yeah.
You know, we could ask them to pitch the new drive, gradually enough that it's still a functional driveway, but sufficient enough that substantial rains predominantly drain to the east.
If that's the case, though, then we're talking about a trench to get it to the to get those to the Caltech as well.
Sure. I mean, you could put it. We've had gravel edges to the north of driveways. No, to the east.
She wants it to the east. This way back, so, and then there'll be
so
a trench along that
okay.
side.
All right. That just seems like the most practical
mm-hmm.
direction.
Is that? Are you amenable to that?
The trench, sure.
Okay.
Not a problem.
Right.
Would you eliminate the Caltech unit next to the driveway?
If
it had a trench?
I can if you prefer it.
So you can do the trench and the Caltech unit?
Yeah, I'm not.
That's fine.
Either one works. Oh, both.
Well,
the trench is inexpensive. It's cheaper than the Caltech in the long run.
If you remove the Caltech unit next to the driveway on the east and you put in a trench, would that trench tie into the main Caltech in the back, go right along the addition and tie into the Caltech in the back?
The reason
it's doing its
Caltech in the back
isn't it doing its own infiltration right there?
Okay,
the trench is
trench.
Infiltrating and it's going to collect the water from the downspout on that corner.
Right.
So it doesn't seem, you know, I don't want to jump in, but I don't think you need both in that corner if you're going to do that 2-foot trench.
Yeah, you're right.
You know, and the bottom line is a Caltech design has to accommodate a certain amount of volume of water that has to be figured out based on the addition area and the amount of rain that's going to hit that addition area. You know, so they have to get that, you know, to see if the Caltech is the right size for the addition.
You have to remember
that
infiltration is under stormwater management, which we don't come under. It's only required for 1 year storm, a 2-inch rainfall.
Right.
It's such a small amount of rainfall that Caltech units have always exceeded the requirement every other event.
Yeah.
They're not made for a 100-year event.
Okay, so
not these.
Yeah.
I like the trench to the east of the driveway, one Caltech in the back, and get that information to us before the next meeting.
That we
yeah,
can
I
do.
Concur with
I think that.
That
would work.
Yep. I would agree.
Are there any questions from the public?
Could you introduce yourself, please?
I'm
Kathy Crotty, 50 7 Cross Street.
Thank you.
And yeah, Judy McCaffrey at 62 Cross Street. I live next door to the new neighbors. I think that
Judy
we
McCaffrey
have,
here too. Judy's wife.
Yep.
Judy's wife.
I think that we haven't been able to see the plans really up close, and one of the concerns was the size of it, the size of the garage and the size of the driveway. And, you know, if we could get a closer look.
Yeah.
mean, it does seem really large. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think that a variance was being asked for the neighbors on the other side of them.
Yeah, that variance is only for 3 feet.
That's a
zoning
variance. Yeah, so that variance doesn't have to do and have anything to do with the wetland.
That's a separate issue.
Zoning.
So with the addition, there's gonna be a complete foundation put in, so doesn't that displace the water? I know this is all, I've lived there my entire life. I was a month old when the house was built. So, I mean, I moved away and came back and bought it again, but. But my thing is that it's a big area to be sunk into the ground, and we have had water issues. There's other people who have tried to put foundations in and haven't been able to, so I'm not opposed to anything that's going on. I just want to know that we're all going to be okay with the water situation. So this filtration system that you're talking about is what's going to draw the water away from all of their land, our land, my neighbors across the street. They get flooded on a regular basis. So that is our process. I've looked out my kitchen window and seen the brook above the ground, above the top. I mean, when we've had substantial rains. So by putting in this, I thought it was going to be a slab at first, and now I understand it's going to be a foundation. So that's like displacing a lot of water. And if it's going to be appropriate, it's all being taken care of, all the power to them, that's wonderful. But that's our main concern, because there's been a couple storms in my lifetime that have come through the garage, because that water comes flying down the street, goes into my driveway, their driveway, my aunt lived next door. And it goes right into over the step, into the garage, over the step that's this big, into the cellar, into the basement. So it's only happened a couple times in 56 years, but it does happen. So if that all that piece of land is being sunk in, is that going to make it worse?
The reason that they are putting in these infiltration systems is to control the increase of the impervious surface.
Okay.
Now, I don't know what's happening to, you're across the street, right?
No, I'm next door.
You're next door?
We're across the street.
We're
not
right
affected as much
yeah.
as the other, of course, as the other side of the
yeah.
street. You know, there has been, I think you probably all know, Cross Street, we've been here a couple of times with other families have tried to put in on that side of the street near the brook, and they've had a difficult time doing it.
And they haven't been able to.
And they haven't been able to do it. So we know, we've been there 34 years, we know there's lots of water in that area.
Right.
I don't know about the table. I know that it's probably pretty high because our backyard usually gets flooded just from the water table itself. So it's good to hear about the infiltration. I wasn't aware of it, and I'm not, it sounds, hopefully, that it would take care of it.
Can I ask a question? The proposed addition, did you have some concept about what type, how deep a foundation you were planning on going?
It's not a foundation. it's just going to be a footing and a slab. It's not like you're not going to be going underneath it. It's just a standard garage footing and foundation.
So it's a garage. The addition itself is a slab garage.
Correct.
Yes, correct.
Okay. So from that standpoint, it shouldn't displace groundwater. Because there's water that comes from above and water that comes from below, and you guys are stuck in between your houses. So the infiltration is going to handle the rain.
Okay.
And the slab is not even going to touch the groundwater. Unless the groundwater comes up to the slab, and then it'll be at the ground surface. Does that help?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. So, do I have a motion?
Make a motion to continue.
I move we continue the notice of intent to the next meeting, when we will get the additional
mm-hmm.
Caltech information, and drip trench design.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
I have a question. Chuck, if we continue to 2 weeks and Steve does what he's supposed to do, will there be order of conditions ready for this project at the next meeting?
It'll be, yeah, it sounds to be a problem having this. I mean, I think we've made a promise that we want to have something for them to sign at the next meeting. There might be some additional items that I need to add to it.
Right.
But I think we can do that.
Yeah, okay. I just wanted to clarify that.
So,
let's vote.
All those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Okay, the next item is a request for determination of applicability for the vegetation management activities along the Keolis commuter rail line. It's been continued at the request of the applicant, but we had some questions that we'd like to, I guess, air. Fair. Yep. So.
Do we air any questions?
Yeah. To, I think, to Chuck, so that, what?
Internally, we can. Who are we airing the questions to?
This is, each other. Each other. I think we want to get it on the record because we want to ask some questions of the applicant.
Sure.
And we want to get it out to them.
So that was at the request. So I talked to the consultant today who's going to come down from Portland, Maine, and talk to us, but he didn't want to make the trip unless he understood some of the questions. And they seem like they'd be quite simple, but put it off for one meeting. He would like the commission to discuss it, get all the questions out. I'll email them to him. And we'll see if we can get some answers that would satisfy the commission.
I apologize. I think I'm the only one that didn't do a site visit to it at this point.
We didn't do a site visit.
Okay, we didn't. Okay.
The whole rail line.
Walking from Wakefield to Wilmington.
The whole thing.
To Wilmington.
Yeah, I saw that.
You also need all kinds of safety training to get on the railroad.
The Keolis right away training.
Technically. Uh-huh. Yeah.
I can do that if you want.
Are you do that?
I have the right away training. If
okay,
we
I used to. Me too. Yeah.
We're not going to take any questions from the audience about here. We do this after we take care of the business. So
no, I want to get this. No, I want to get this going. It's not going to take a long time.
Okay.
One of the things I noticed is that it was the National Wetlands, and I don't see our wetlands or DEP's wetland line, so I don't know if this is extensive as it can be. I went on and looked at their vegetation management plan, and I looked at some of the material safety data sheets or the herbicides that they're using. The only one that I thought could be a potential problem was the glyphosate, which is typical Roundup. And that has been shown to be kind of toxic to frog larvae.
Yeah.
And not so much salamanders. And we have a certified vernal pool near one of the limited spray zones, which is at a 1 year interval. And I don't know how far away that is. And I don't know the timing of their spraying. It's a foliar spraying, so they do that from those trucks, the high rails, that go along the ballast, the railroad. And what kind of questions? So the question would be, you know, when do they expect to spray?
Time of year.
Yeah.
We
would like it not to coincide with the time that the vernal pool would be most active, which is right around this time.
Not a spring season spray.
Anika, do you have any other comments?
No. No, I think
you pretty much summed up the comments I had.
Okay.
So the, is the vernal pool the one just about an inch west of number 12? So no spring spraying, right?
I would hope not. No.
I mean, we could extend that to the whole reach. I mean, there's two vernal, well, that's not, what's the scale?
I mean, those are, about a quarter mile over, eighth. So
yeah,
they're not that far.
It's not that far off. I mean, that's sort of out of our jurisdictional area. But the wetlands aren't.
It was, it is the wetlands.
And the zone
two questions.
Two.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we have.
Yeah.
Use the town GIS wetland map, or at least compare the town, the state, and the regional one. And then the spraying near the vernal pool and timing.
Yep, timing.
So
do we have jurisdiction over the zone two? Interim wellhead protection area? That isn't in our regulations. That's not our
Mm-mm.
official authority.
Mm-mm.
I was going to say, it'd be great if those herbicides also.
There's overlap.
Didn't have
this is wetland, and this is wetland.
Yeah, yeah.
But in between, no.
It's
the wellhead.
It'd be great if they could ensure that spraying didn't have a potential to damage the drinking water standards in the interim wellhead protection area, but that would require probably modeling and might be beyond the purview. Plus, they might be exempt anyway, right? Because they're
mm-hmm.
a utility. Yeah, I'm most concerned about the vernal pool.
Any questions, Amy? Okay. Move on to the next item. We have a 740 request for determination of applicability at 2016-861 Hopkins Street, map 7, lot 48, Couillard.
I'm going to recuse myself.
And did you folks take a, no, you didn't.
I did not. Amy?
I went. We went.
Who went on site visits?
You were there.
Jamie. Us too.
I guess Mr. Couillard is proposing to do some filling in his backyard to bring some of the uneven grassed area up to flatten it out and up to grade. What was confusing on the plan to us was that he had identified this area within the 35-foot building zone adjacent to the wetland area, but his intent is not necessarily to go all the way down there. It's more to take out his shed and to feather in an area. So we had asked if he could provide a grading plan to really indicate to us what he's proposing to do, and I see that there's
that's
one
what
up
we
there.
Got earlier today.
Yep. Let's see if we can just get this bigger.
Okay, so how much what's the maximum amount of fill that's going in there?
What do you
what's
mean?
The maximum depth? I'm just trying to understand. So it's 62, what's that, 58?
At its highest point,
4 feet.
About 4 feet.
About
4 feet. And that's.
What's the purpose of doing all that filling?
Because right now this is about a 4 foot different here. And this is all swaled in and unlevel and basically unusable. So what I'm proposing is to level this grade and then slowly grade to level the whole area.
without ever, this is a 35 buffer, but I won't be going near that. It's grading all in this area out into here just to grade and level the yard. I know you couldn't make the site visit, but if you saw it,
it's sort of, the house drops off and then it's like a step in the middle of the yard.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not changing the direction of the slope. It's just, literally, it's just smoothing it out.
Yep. And the existing yard is grass?
Yeah.
Yes.
Conditions are grass. Any trees coming down?
No.
Any other... Got the vegetation,
are you
pruning
removing
or cutting?
The shed?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So the.
See the shed?
Yeah, I see the shed. So, yeah, I was a little unsure the exact nature of the scope of work. So, removing the shed. With excavator or.
Well, the shed's a old dilapidated aluminum shed on a concrete slab, so there'd be no excavation, just
take the aluminum
apart.
And leave the slab?
Yes.
Okay. Never mind. Different question. There's a line on the plan that looks like there's a fence in the middle of your yard between the corner. You see that with the line with the dots? Black dots on it.
This is a fence.
Nope, that's not what I'm talking about. Middle of your yard.
No, there's no other fence.
Right here?
No, what's that?
Good question.
Is that just a figure mistake or?
I think what it was, the prior, it wasn't really a fence. The prior occupant had wire mesh. To hold up plants and vegetation, he had pounded some metal stakes in. And then run some metal around them. The plan doesn't show, but over here there's some blueberry bushes, Becky, that you saw that had the metal bar around them with the
mm-hmm.
mesh on them.
Right.
So that's what that was.
That's
Is
not
that
there
existing?
Anymore.
That's not there. No, I just.
Okay, so that's a ghost kind of
yes,
feature to the
yes.
plan. Okay.
Any questions from the commission?
I have one question. Al, it looks like by the driveway that you're directing some of the runoff in the direction of the other, onto the other property. Are you thinking of doing an infiltration trench there to capture that or regrade that somehow so it goes more into the backyard? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I'm going to talk to my neighbor. And I was planning on grading it and just leveling it out in between the two properties.
You think that, because it's what is it, 162 to 154, you're gonna be getting something when it rains in that direction. Whether and there's not too much you can level out, you can level it out the last 10 feet.
Where are you talking about?
Talking about right here, can you see the cursor?
Yeah.
It's coming down in this direction here. All this goes downward, and you're gonna be sending everything in this direction, or not everything, some of it. So I was wondering if you were thinking about some sort of infiltration along here to not direct that water onto the property, or if you've discussed it with the other property owner, and you know, basically, what's your thoughts on that?
Well, my intent right now was to just make it as level as possible and let any of the runoff sheath. It's all lawn, my neighbor's lawn and my lawn. And it's kind of running, it's not running to a resource area. I mean, I could put a drip trench in if I had to along the lot line there.
Was there a driveway there before?
The driveway was. A little closer to the left. It was just on the other side. It was the existing driveway was on this side of the tree. And it was quite long. Did it go past the house? I forget, the greenhouse.
I don't remember.
It didn't go past the house. It went right up to the front corner of the greenhouse. So the existing driveway was about where this was in here, right here, going in the same direction, doing the same thing.
And so,
Is there an order of conditions with the driveway that's
outside the 100?
No,
no,
so
it's outside.
Oh, that's outside the 100.
Yeah, this is the 100-foot buffer here. So the house and the driveway is all the buffer.
Any other questions from the commission? Are you planning to do any additional plantings near the 35-foot or between the 35 and the, sorry, I didn't get to the site visits. Just wondering, how's the vegetated buffer zone?
Well,
looking there
along the property line from the shed, in between the.
Yeah.
The fence where my lot line is a stone wall. It's only maybe 12 to 18 inches high, but it runs the whole length of the property.
That's the property line, is the stone wall?
Yes. And on this side of the stone wall is all grass right up to the stone wall.
Right up to the stone wall.
Yeah. And the other side is the topography falls right off. It's very steep. There's a bunch of debris and cut down trees and stuff over there that I've been taken out by hand and cleaning up.
Would you be interested in planting anything within your 25-foot ZNV?
Chuck, can you raise that plant up a little
bit? Sure thing.
Nope.
Yeah, hold on.
If anything, I'd like to do something down here.
Why that area?
I want some additional screening there.
Where are the apple trees, just for reference?
The apple trees are here.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe a little farther down there.
So you could transplant those blueberry bushes down.
Yeah, well,
the
yeah.
Aren't they already within the
ZNV? No, the existing blueberries are right in front of the shed right here.
How many you got there?
Three. Three full size, like 5 quarters.
Be better than having them ripped out.
Yeah.
So I guess that's another part is, so with all this filling, what, no trees are gonna be cut, but what other vegetation besides these blueberry bushes are gonna get?
Just
the blueberries are gonna be destroyed as part of the
Well, the blueberries, I want to transplant
there.
Them. I want to move
the
lawn.
Yeah.
There's blueberry bushes.
Blueberries.
I don't know,
yeah.
I should have made it to the
it
site.
Looked like there was
like
a garden out there at one point, but it's pretty much all open except for the perimeter of the property. I mean, there could be some planting, you know, but those blueberry bushes, if you could replace them,
that would be good.
Replant them.
Yeah, that's what I want to do, yeah.
that would be great.
Yeah, what about, are there existing bounds at the 35 or the 25, or are there markers of any sort?
Flag A10 is in place. I marked it with a stake.
Yeah.
And I also marked A9, and I pulled off the marker and the stake, and
sure
I marked the ground with orange spray paint.
It's really well defined, because it's literally what today you have is a very uneven meadow, and then it just drops off, and it's trees and debris down to the wetland.
And the drop off is
just
off the property.
It's right here.
Yeah, it's the property line. Yeah, I get it. With the stone wall at the top. Okay. No, I understand. I think saving those blueberry bushes would be good. Moving them, keeping them on your property, keeping them within the ZNV.
Any more trees? Or you? He's going to do that anyways. Sounds like you just got this place, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's going to be planting.
Any questions from the public? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Janet Davidson D. I live at 36 Mile Post Road, and my property is on this side of the your property.
Behind?
I'm behind you. I have the longest I think, aside from the dunes.
Are you on the opposite side of the wetland?
If you raise that up, I'm, when you went down the hill, I'm to the left.
Oh, okay.
Those were my blueberry bushes at the bottom of,
Okay, yeah, I know where you are.
So I'm just simply, obviously.
You're over in this area.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, you know, obviously I'm concerned about the filling and moving of dirt and the effect, the impact
well,
it would have on the water table, because I've never had a water problem and, but.
I shouldn't, technically, I shouldn't really talk to you directly, but you should ask the chair. You want me to just talk to?
You're the kind of applicant.
So yeah, it shouldn't affect you. The grading is, you know where the garden was?
Oh yes.
That's where the grading is gonna stop. I'm gonna go from the back of my new house, and I'm gonna go there, where the garden was is a rock in the middle of the garden. A few feet before that rock, the grade is gonna be about the same grade as the new driveway I put in.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna go from my new driveway and just level it out just to just before that rock.
Yep.
So it's another 40 or 60 feet from where I'm going to be grading down to where I get into your blueberry bushes or your lot line. So it shouldn't affect you at all. It'll all be loomed and seeded. And
that's great. No, I appreciate that. It's not as extensive as I thought it was.
So what I hear is, you're, Mr. Couliard, you're going to transplant those existing three blueberry bushes down into the 25-foot or 35-foot?
Yes.
Did we get any resolve on the infiltration on the side of the driveway?
Yeah, that was gonna be my follow up question. What does the commission want, infiltration there, or just leave it up to Al and his neighbor? Is that neighbor here tonight?
Yes, he's here.
So we were talking about infiltration. Oops, what happened here? Between your house and where the runoff, some of this runoff from the driveway and from this filling is going to go in this back area here.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm proposing, or I've asked Al, to think about putting an infiltration so it doesn't just sweep onto your yard.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of left it open after that. So I didn't know if you had concerns about water. It's just going to be surface water.
Yeah, not really.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be the same as that it's been for years. I don't think it'll be any more, right? It'll just be the same amount of water going in the same direction. If anything, I might be pushing a little past his property line there, going down into the.
And it's just going to be grassed in area, right?
It's just
going
to be grassed in area, yeah. So. I don't think it'll be an issue, but if somebody has concerns about it, I don't think it's going to be an issue.
Okay. So we have removed the shed and moved three blueberry bushes. And any other concerns?
Any from the audience? Public?
I make a motion for a negative determination pending the two additional items that were discussed tonight.
Yep.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Abstained?
Thank you, guys. Thank you. You guys know I have any concerns.
Opposed?
Ring the bell.
Oh, I didn't see her.
I seconded. I'm sorry. I didn't.
Yeah, I don't know if you voted.
I know. I just. It's been a long time.
Confusing.
Sorry.
Okay, thank you. This is a continuation of the notice of intent for 270-0658 Low Meadow off of Arcadia Avenue, map 14, lot 15, Haskell. And the public hearing is reopened for and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Mass General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40 as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. The applicant will present the proposal. Commission will receive reports, technical advice from
technical advisor to town departments. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. The public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which you should be directed to the chair. And when you do, give your name and address. And I would encourage everybody to sign in if you haven't already. At this time, would members of the CONCOM please introduce themselves, starting on my right?
Julie Roger, recording secretary.
Amy Shukatani.
Al Couillard.
Rebecca Longley, chair.
Anika Scanlon, vice chair.
Michael Flynn.
Harry Curtis.
Chuck Tarone, conservation administrator.
And the applicants.
I am Stephen Erickson from North Environmental Services. Since our last meeting, what we've done is Mr. Tyrone has shown that this is in fact a river, a perennial stream. Green stats in the USGS map, the boat marked. Never saw that before, but we got it in this case. So the wetland boundary remains the same, nothing on that has changed, but we did add the riverfront flags right through this area, and of course, virtually the entire lot is within the 100-foot riverfront area. All of it is within the 200-foot. But that's the only change that we've shown that as a perennial stream now.
My initial question is, I assume because there's flags here that you went out and sort of approximated a top of bank out there somewhere.
I actually, when I first went out there, I flagged it as a riverfront. The surveyor went up and located it. It was after that I realized it didn't show up on the USGS, and I ran stream stats on it and realized that according to the regulations, it would be intermittent. But according to the science, it's perennial. Like, I can't disagree with Mr. Tony.
So, but these are actual locations that you have flagged.
Annual high water, yes.
I would just add that, when we went out to site visit, I remember seeing the RF.
Right at the base of the slope, right along with the DVW boundary.
No, I did. I think I saw them too.
Steve, what happens up here on the C series? Did you run out of bank?
Oh, this area?
No, C. The off of Arnold Ave, the cul-de-sac ending. Yeah.
No, they were flagged. They were.
Those are B.
So typically missing
B and C.
Right.
Yeah, but my question, sorry, is that riverfront area as well. Where is the channel?
The river heads out this way. Still probably stays on the property, but it's pretty much inaccessible. The only way I could possibly get that would be scuba gear or the GIS system.
About a kayak. No,
but
kidding.
At that point, all of our work is going to be away from that anyhow.
When we walked out there, Chuck.
Yes.
Stephen and I walked on Monday afternoon at 2 o'clock. There were two branches. One you had walked through. One went to the right, looking down, actually to the west. There's one going almost north, and then there's another main channel.
This is the closer channel. There is a channel that's further out.
Yep. Okay.
But I doubt that either of them actually dries up at this point. So we took the closer channel, assuming that would be the riverfront. There was a reasonable argument to that effect.
And can you just explain why you only flagged that smaller part of the overall river?
If you look at this part over here, the riverfront starts to go up in this direction, which means that the riverfront would be this area, and it's not the area that we're interested in. The riverfront actually goes up here, then turns back over in this direction. But since I've already got virtually the entire lot in the 100-foot riverfront area, it's a moot point.
Okay. I just wanted that to be stated.
Yeah.
I assume that. I just wanted to be done. Okay. I don't have any other questions.
So, Chuck, enlighten us, if you can, on... Is it the performance standards for the inner riparian zone? And that is, the inner riparian zone is from the top of bank out 100 feet. So
we're just doing an ANRAD here, and we're approving the resource area, which is the wetland line and the riverfront line. And the commission hasn't gone out and verified the wetland line. I'm not sure if they have. I think that some of the flags were there and some of the flags weren't there. So you need to decide whether you want to do that also. But I'm just only going to get into the riverfront just a little bit. So at to get into to even get into a project within the first 100 feet, it needs to be an improvement over an existing conditions. But we don't have a project in front of us.
Mm-hmm.
So there's more to it, but that's a big, big part of it.
Okay.
And there's also that 5,000 square foot rule. Oh, yeah, I thought you know.
You can't. It wasn't there a percentage?
There is, or 10%, something like that, of the riverfront. So it's either you can disturb, and you'd have to, I think 2-to-1 for that, and another spot if you had it, or it's a percentage of that bank. So it's not. There's still options at this point, and it needs to be looked at. And I think that when we discovered this was riverfront, and we were out there with Steve, there were a couple of options. And it was obviously, think about what we have right now. And I just thinking that for myself, that if it was no possibility, then we wouldn't be here tonight. So there still might be
mm-hmm.
something that can work in this area. I mean, that's not coming from me. I'm just reading the tea leaves.
And this is an ANRAD, so
that's
right.
This is for the line.
Now, so we need.
Did we not?
So are you asking if all the members of the commission are comfortable with
Yeah, I'm asking
their
if
location.
All the members of the have
okay.
not specifically gone out there and checked the flags for the riverfront.
So just remind me, because I thought last time, particularly with the A line, at least let's concentrate on the A line. I thought that you guys went out with Steve even before last meeting, and there were two locations that were decided. Am I rather the wrong site?
No, you got the right site. Uh-huh. Remember when we were out there a couple weeks ago,
yeah.
you saw the RF flags
yep.
a little bit beyond the wetland flags.
Correct.
And we said, oh, well, somebody said, what's that for? I said, probably a riverfront.
Yeah.
And so we did see them. But we didn't, as a group, we didn't go out after that.
But the flags haven't changed.
No, so we looked at the, so Chuck, Rebecca, and I went.
Okay.
And we looked at all of the wetland flags also on Arnold Avenue.
Okay.
And we had three, maybe four, that we thought should have been moved
mm-hmm.
as much as 3 feet. But we were basically in agreement.
And those have been moved on the
plan.
Yeah,
and those have been moved.
Those have already been moved on the plan.
Correct.
I saw maybe three or four riverfront flags, but I don't remember seeing one and two. And it may be because I wasn't looking for them. But it may
be. I think some were missing.
Some were missing. I know there was some issue with some missing. So I think for our purposes, because this is not the easiest thing we'll look at, I want to go back and see exactly where these flags are, just to understand, even if we don't put more flags in below RF1, to understand which direction the river goes, make sure it doesn't switch back or anything, and then further out RF6, just for our own understanding. Just to confirm that those flags
okay.
are,
and that could be
from
on the next site.
If the riverfront moved toward the site another 5 feet or 10 feet, it wouldn't make a bit of difference. And obviously, it can't go 10 feet.
It doesn't.
It
doesn't
rising 4 feet.
I agree with you, but it makes a difference.
It's
my piece of mind as
a
commissioner.
Point. It's like worrying about the riverfront that's headed in the northerly direction. It just doesn't have any impact.
And that's all great until I run into somebody at Stop and Shop and they say, did you actually see those flags? And I want to be able to say yes.
Fine with me, I don't really care.
So again, we don't have the order ready, and it gives the commission an opportunity to go out at the next site visit and see that, and then we can decide, I'll write the order based on what this plan shows, and if there needs to be subtle changes, we'll be able to incorporate those in the process.
I just want to comment, you know, I respect that that decision. I just want to comment that in general, based on my memory of what the territory looked like, what's written on the plan right now to me looks reasonable, you know, overall. You know, I don't expect it would change substantially
change
at all. Yeah. So I think the lines are pretty much.
And if it changes a little bit, it's still, everything's still in the 100-foot buffer, the 100-foot intermediarian.
Yeah. What has to be.
So,
yeah.
I think it still doesn't matter. You know, we've got the time. We have to gather the conditions anyway.
Right.
So.
Right.
And you know what? If I'm
it gives
the
us
only
the
one
opportunity.
That way, I can go stomp around in the woods. I actually don't mind that.
No.
This weekend.
I think
well,
it
you have the opportunity anyway.
Yeah. So maybe I'll just do that if I'm the only one that wants to go do that.
Well, you can decide.
You're free to.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So.
So I don't object to this.
So, the majority are agreeing.
So I make a motion to continue, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. You gotta continue.
to the next meeting.
So that we have
the opportunity
to
go see the final waivers front flags.
Okay. Do I hear a second?
I thought I was saying I was the only one. You want to do that too?
I think we're not gonna have time to approve it until next meeting, anyways.
Okay. All right.
It makes sense. Why do it now? Let's
okay.
give us the opportunity. So,
okay.
My opinion is well.
Okay.
And I apologize, Becky. I don't think we asked for the public.
No, we haven't yet.
So I was getting excited.
All right. I'll entertain questions from the public. If they're new questions and okay. Your name, please.
My name is Charlotte Harlan, and I live on Arcadia Avenue. And I just heard about this recently. And I actually have written a letter about, I thought I might read it, but I don't need to do that. I can give it to you. I've lived there since 1968. And I had heard there was a question about whether the river in back of us has ever dried up, or it's always been watering it always.
Okay.
I also spent some time on the phone with Bob Lotzenheiser. I think you know who that is.
He was meteorologist. He's
a 100-year-old, wonderful meteorologist, climatologist who has lived here in Reading since 1956. On Arcadia Avenue when that whole development was first built and opened. And I talked to him yesterday, and he said when he moved here, the river was there. It has never, ever been dry. It's always been there, sometimes higher, sometimes lower.
Thank you very much.
I do have a letter that I want to give you about that.
Yeah. We that's what we have decided, and we've actually spent quite a bit of time and met with Mr. Erickson, and we have concurred that that is a perennial river.
Yep. Well,
I heard that. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Maria Salvatelli, 25 Arnold Avenue. For the benefit of the audience, could you please explain to us what is it that the purpose of this meeting is right now, as far as, and yes, if you need backup, yes, please go do what you need to do to find out where those markers are. We appreciate that as a community for you doing that, and if other people can join you, that would be even better to have that reinforcement as well. So I appreciate you following through with that. Thank you. The question I have is, what is it in that we're trying to accomplish this evening?
The purpose of this meeting and the previous meeting,
yep,
was to identify what the resource areas, the wetlands resource areas that are under the protection of the wetlands,
right,
Massachusetts wetlands, and our Reading bylaws, which as a commission, we have jurisdiction over that. So we, you know, look to our administrator for his expertise and any of our expertise, and that's, you know, the question was the last time, you know, was this a riverfront area or not? And that would have been added to what had been identified as a bordering vegetated wetland. And we did spend quite a bit of time. We reviewed or talked to our town engineer, and there have been quite a few studies in the past about these watersheds, and there was one done by AECOM, which was the old Metcalf and Eddy over in Wakefield. And I believe Mr. Taroni talked to that project manager, and that study did identify that particular reach of the Abajona River as river area.
So we confirmed that, but I guess the next question is regarding the flags, so that we're just taking that to the next level and determining what part of the plot of land that he's wanting to build on. Is that where we're at right now?
We're going to go out and do a site inspection,
yep,
to look at the flags that have been put along those the edge of the resource areas to confirm or say, you know, we think it's a different location. I do not suspect that it's going to be a huge difference in the location, but yes, that would be the next thing that we would be doing before our next meeting. We usually have our site visits a couple days before.
So Becky, what I'll just add is typically what happens is our jurisdiction is based off of those flag locations. So typically with this ANRAD process, applicants want to come in and find out ahead of time where the jurisdictional lines are,
okay,
so that they understand what's
where
everything,
buildable kind of
where everything kind of lies on their, who they have are going to have to talk to when they actually get into the process.
Okay. Thank you for that
explanation. So we also don't tell the applicant where they can build. He'll propose a plan with a building site on it that he thinks he can defend and meets the performance standards of the Wetlands Protection Act and our town bylaws, and then we'll evaluate it. So that's why we're only looking at this. This is what this applicant's presented, and this is what we're kind of giving our approval on at this point. And once he knows that, you know, he can go through the Wetlands Protection Act and our own town bylaws and try to figure out where something will work or won't work. So it's really a waiting game. It's really up to the consultant and his knowledge of how to develop land that will bring this project forward from this point.
So, and again, what I would just add, so as we've decided on, you know, we're trying to finalize this jurisdictional line, you know, on a site like this, as you heard Steve say, everything's going to be within our jurisdiction, you know, is within the 100-foot line. So
right,
no matter what, when something gets proposed, it's coming back here if they plan on doing something.
Right. Yeah. It's all
Hi. Yep. Yes, please. Dave Rochi, 117 Arcadia. I actually live next door where he's presenting. And my question was, in my notes, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that the meeting that we had last time, at the very end, you granted this next meeting for the 100-foot zone, for, you know, the market. And my question is, I know you haven't seen the site and you're going back out there. Can you help me and tell me how you determine the 100 feet and why you think it might change or might not change in your...
So
in
the 100-foot is the for a buffer zone, so for
correct,
the wetland part.
Right.
So...
Sure.
How is he going
could
to
you
determine
just zoom
that
in
if he doesn't take a kayak? Because
area.
I wrote in my notes.
So that's going to be, he needs to determine where it's wet.
Right.
Based on not just water, but soils too. So it's going to be a little bit beyond where it's usually wet. And then he establishes a line at that point. Okay? And we're approving that line.
So from that line forward, which we know is gonna be, with this site, it's steep. So it can't really move that much, but the standard rule of thumb is the width of professional judgment is about 5 feet. So it's gonna go 5 feet in either direction, and this site is gonna go 3 inches in either direction, okay? It's a steep site. So every time you go up 3 inches or go over 3 inches, you're up 6 or 9 inches. So you gotta be within 18 inches of a wet area. So if you're going up above that, 2 feet, then you're well out of it. So you can't be 2 feet above what is wet or what the soils are and still be in a wetland. So we're gonna put the line somewhere in that area. So everyone here understands that. I know I understand it's confusing. So we're generally saying that 100 feet is about right where those flags are, and 100 feet off of those flags is on this plan right here. And that first line is...
It's tough to see on... this is zoomed out, but... So, and we've got a large plan, so we know what that... But these are the flags that they've marked for wetland, and then these are the additional flags that was part of the conversation last time of, is this a river, where is the river located? This RF line is what we're saying is the...
And you expect to see those flags in that transitional area between the wet area and where it starts to get dry. Mm-hmm. That's where
can
they're gonna be.
Make a determination? The committee makes a determination or does?
No, nothing, so Steve presents where the flags are. It's up to the commission to approve the line.
Okay.
So the commission, that's why they've done a site visit. They probably feel comfortable with the wetland line, but there's some confusion about the riverfront line, so they want to go out again.
Now, I didn't see them move any of the lines from, say, A1 through A3, but you mentioned that earlier.
We did was, and this is standard, not just with this project and this applicant, is we just say at A3, move the flag up 3 feet. And we sent an email to the applicant, and all those moves were made. And it was the chair of the commission that sent me the numbers and the flags that she wanted moved up. And I sent those to the applicant, and those changes have been made. Does it mean that someone has to go back out in the field and move the flags? No, not really.
No.
I mean, we're beyond, the commission is beyond that at this point.
Okay.
They should understand that this is a scale of 1 inch is equal to 30 feet. Moving a flag 3 feet is a tenth of an inch on the plan.
Okay.
It's indiscernible to the average person.
Right. In other words, we were being a little picky. You.
Yeah.
So
I didn't follow it.
Yeah, so that's kind of how it works, and the same thing's going to happen here. Now, if it was a flat site, yeah, you could be 4, 5, 7 feet away. I mean, you really could. We are lucky that this commission has a lot of soil science experience. So
yeah, well then, we'll discuss that one later. But my other question is that now that he's saying that it is a river, why is there a change now in going forward with the plan?
Now that he's saying it,
he was saying it was intermittent stream in the first committee meeting that we had. Now he's recanting and saying it's a river front. Now he's agreeing with us that it's a river.
Well, that just gets back to the presentation and the approval process. The commission was confronted with the fact that the way the Wetlands Protection Act is written, that the first thing you look at is what's those maps?
The USGS.
USGS maps.
Right.
And if it's a blue line on the USGS map, or solid, thicker blue line, it's perennial. If it's thin, it's intermittent. We actually got, in the latest map, no line whatsoever. So it was missing. But the Wetlands Protection Act thinks of that too. So if it's not missing, or not shown at all, or you have some questions about it, you go to Stream Stats, and Stream Stats allows you to do these calculations through a computer program, and it calculates the drainage area, and the drainage area needs to be 1 square mile, or half a square mile if it had certain sand in the soil, which we didn't have. So at that point, you know, Steve was right to say, look, I've done a little bit of searching. He doesn't know what happens in this town. He doesn't have the ability to look back at every permit that was pulled on Arnold Ave and Arcadia and Longwood Ave, which I did, and see that every time that had happened, it was considered riverfront, which we also had a commission member saying that he was at these AECOM meetings, and they considered it riverfront. But that space between the railroad tracks on Willow Ave and the highway is the orphan of every study that has ever been done. No study went down through that Arcadia Ave area, so it was a little bit difficult. So the commission decided to go on a field trip, and I actually walked that river and plotted each one with my GIS and did waypoints, and with that I thought there was enough visual evidence to bring Steve out there and let him understand what I saw, and he came out. We probably took 45 minutes to an hour to look at that area and down further, down Longwood Ave. And after the site work was over, there was no question about it that we were in agreement that it was riverfront. So now a new line needs to be shown on the plan, which is like another hurdle. So now the applicant needs to jump over two hurdles to do his project. The 100-foot line and now the riverfront designation. So, but you know, just to put it in perspective, nothing kills a project. The only thing that the Wetlands Protection Act says is that you have to show that you're not going to harm the resource area.
Well, that's
and you have to meet the performance standards.
Will that affect the watersheds?
Will it affect what?
Will the building affect the watersheds?
This is a high piece of ground. You're so far above.
There is no building.
Yeah.
Well,
there's no building proposed, so
yeah.
We don't have any answer to that.
Yeah, I guess we don't.
Right.
We could guess.
Until there is a building.
Yeah.
And then it would have to be brought
right.
in front of this
we'll
commission
discuss
again.
It when it's
right.
Right.
And
so.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Okay. Do I hear?
So now I'll make a motion
okay.
to continue until when's our next meeting?
27th.
April 27th.
I'll second.
Thanks. I think we have a question.
I inject
another
question
for this vote. There's no opportunity. Your return to the field.
Your name, please?
Tom Carr, 22 Garrett Road.
Thank you.
Will there be an opportunity for interested in potentially impacting neighbors to accompany you on the when you return to the site?
You know, that's private
yeah.
property, so I can't answer. I can't give you permission to do that.
I think all the neighbors who are interested are here and would be very happy to do that. Either to designate a participant to represent them, or what would the reason be, given that the abutters favored that? What would the reason
first
be
of all, this is private property. I mean, I can't give anybody any permission. We have to look at that, you know, because we are part of the commission. That's our calling, not our job.
Mm-hmm.
But I can't give you, we as a commission can't give any of the abutters permission to access private property. And it would be.
If he goes on the property with you, that's not the property in question, he could accompany, is that correct?
The property isn't posted. So
it doesn't matter. It's private property.
I understand that. But
so he walks around the perimeter of the property? He can, is there a reason why he wouldn't be able to join you?
If I could speak.
Sorry.
I frankly don't care if people walk on the property, but I can't get permission from my client. And it's got steep slopes, so he's going to say no because he doesn't want any liability. If you can get permission from one of the neighbors to walk on their property and look at it, then
you could do that.
And
yes.
That's okay.
Most of the
and
steep slopes and a number of your flags are on these the properties owned by these people here.
But just like I can't give you permission to walk on my client's property, I can't give you permission to walk on the neighbor's property or them permission to walk on your property. So if you can get some permission from somebody else, go ahead. I don't care if people look at it. Doesn't matter to me, but I can't give the, I don't have the authority to give somebody permission.
I think one of the real difficulties here is that the confidence that people would have in understanding the report is perhaps compromised a little bit when you have flags currently in place that are out in the middle of the channels in this river. People might understand the process by which
Can I address that? Just so our purpose is to just establish agreement on where those flags that those flags accurately represent the wetland condition, right?
Yep.
So the applicant submits a drawing with the flags.
Sure.
Our job is to make sure we've got to get comfortable that those flags are in the right place. We're all appointed by the selectmen, and it's our job to represent the community and to follow the Mass Wetlands Protection Act. So it's our job to go out there and convince ourselves that those flags are in the right place. And that's what we're going to do on behalf of the community. We don't have an interest in anything other than just getting them in the right place. Because for every abutter who doesn't like where the flags are, there's a builder who doesn't like where the flags are either, a property owner. So it's our job to just try to get it right, get the flags in the right place. And so we're going to, just as Chuck said, we put our boots on and we're going to walk through the river and say, this is what we think the bank is, and this is where the flag is, and yeah, we agree with that. Does that help clarify the process?
It does. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have a motion. We have a second.
All in favor?
Those in favor? All those abstain? Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Chuck, thank you for organizing the field trip. And figuring out that this is actually a river. I think that's great to see and have. It's great to make it work.
Yes, please. Thank you.
It's confirmation is what it is. Thank you.
I got your email. There you go.
Thank you.
Like you framed it, eventually. Just pass that to Chuck.
That is, we're here
doing multiple of these projects in Redwood. Yes,
So he wants to know exactly what he thinks he's got a path to develop. He may not. We're not sure. Establishing this, what he's trying to get us to do, which we'll do in a few weeks, then he'll go back and in a month or so he'll come back and file a notice of intent with us, and then we'll see what he's proposing, how, why, and where, and we'll address all those issues at that time.
Right.
Yeah.
That's why we have public meetings, so you can get it all out.
That's what it's for. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Next on the agenda. Oops, it goes my agenda. Oh, 37, we went to 37 James Road?
Yeah.
The planting plan for Crystal Island?
That's how I said it.
Is that how we pronounce
sure.
it?
Yeah.
Anika and I actually looked at this.
Is this the one with the cedars in the back? Okay. It was emailed today?
There.
Yep.
Yep.
Yep. Okay.
Yes. Apparently, Chuck, you want to talk about this? This was before my time. And...
So, this is just a step that was incorporated into the order of conditions, and we asked that the applicant, we asked two things, that the applicant plant five shrubs and four trees in our order of conditions. They've taken down many trees, but we only asked for that amount to be replaced inside the order of conditions. And the applicant has, and then we asked for him to provide a plan showing us what he intends to do. So this plan shows the whole project and where he's going to do planting. But for the commission, he's the four eastern red cedar are going to go along this area here. They'll fill in between later on, and he's going to plant five high bush blueberry down in the wet area beyond the retaining wall. The commission originally asked that some abrevidae be planted along here, but the neighbor has taken care of that already, and this tree row right here is all abrevidae. So we have white cedar, and that's going to go up in this area here, but it's outside of our jurisdiction. It's outside the 100 foot, and there's some white spruce. It's going to go in this area here, just two of them. Mark assures me that he will be planting more, but he wanted to fulfill this requirement that the commission asked him to do. So he had someone put this plan together, and one of the other complications was, and this is why we went through this with sticking these notepads, is that he has a service dog, and his first service dog had a problem with eating some of the berries that were either on this site or somewhere else. So he had to get a new service dog, and he wants to make sure that anything he plants doesn't have berries or anything toxic to this new dog, because they do cost quite a bit of money. So blueberries seem to be fine, and the rest are trees.
I just have a quick question. I have no objection to the number or the location of the trees and bushes. Just a question, and maybe you can answer it or Al can chime in. The place where the trees are planted, is there a chance that the roots are going to interfere with the structural integrity of the wall, of the retaining wall there? I'm thinking long term.
How high is the wall?
What's the wall made out of, Chuck?
Huge boulders.
Boulders?
Huge.
I wasn't sure if it was blocks.
Yeah, they are.
If it's boulders, it might be fine.
Boulders that are on that wall. They had to wait to get these things in three or four
stages. The roots would be able to
intertwine.
Yeah.
And actually hold up that slope a little bit.
Right, so it's a boulder wall, and this is going to be at the top of it, it's angled down towards the back. So
I just want to make sure whatever we approve doesn't degrade the wall or
right.
Also, I didn't mention
that he's going to put in three white pines right here in this area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So now he's over what we've asked.
Which is great.
So maybe I didn't follow this. I thought you had indicated that he was not over what we asked.
I thought you were saying he was under.
Nope. I said he's met our requirements.
Yeah, that's
what I thought I read in the email that he didn't meet the requirements.
Yeah, I thought I did too, but that's fine. Whatever. If it's over, it's great.
No. This Mark is he's a, you know, self-starter. He's a guy that's come out here on his own and put this thing together on his own, and he came to my office 3 times to work on this over the course of he has a lot of other things to do. But he came in, he wanted to make sure that this was taken care of, and he came in 3 times with all his decisions and brought him back to his house and kind of went through this, and this is what he thinks he can do, and for the safety of the dog, and for what he can propose for this year. And that's why he didn't want to say, look, I'm going to, just like it says here, I'm going to plant all this stuff. He didn't want to have you guys think that that's what's going to happen. He's only going to plant what I just talked about.
So what are we approving here? This is
not an approval. Inside the order of conditions, we needed to review his plan and make suggestions. So if you don't have any suggestions, tomorrow I'm going to tell him that the commission told him that it sounds like a good idea. Please move forward.
Any further questions or
I have
or
no
comments?
Suggestions. I think it's fine as
yeah. Amy, all set with it?
Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes people read that in the order of conditions and never do it. This is a gentleman that read it in the order of conditions and thought it was important enough and got a plan made. And
it's good. Yeah. I appreciate his effort.
Yeah, I think it's good. I just reread your email. You said he met the requirements. I don't know why. I think I just read it as it does not meet the requirements.
I thought I read the same thing.
I thought it sounded fine.
I know Chuck had a hard time reading the names, but that guy, that gentleman, Bill Fleming, is a registered landscape architect.
Yeah, I did have a hard time reading those names.
I've worked with him in the past.
Yeah. So that was some of the complication.
The next item on the agenda was a certificate of compliance for 30 Gavin Circle, but it's continued at the request of the applicant.
Can we talk about it?
Do we really need to? Because we had the same
okay.
opinion.
It's a mess.
Yes.
Shouldn't have cut down the trees.
They say they're going to clean it up, Chuck.
Shouldn't
have
cut down
call?
The trees. Needs to take out the fill.
So I called after. You know, one of the confusing things is to go on sidewalks in two groups.
Right.
We're going to talk about that.
But what really works is to have me in one of the groups, because then I can take all these action items back to the office and you know, turn them into phone calls or emails. So I called up the gentleman at 30 Gavin Circle. I even said it to him. I said, I think you're looking at some cleanup here.
You said
here.
That on the
sidewalk.
You
yeah.
said that.
I mean, it was, yeah. So... I gave him a call. He's able to he was able to find a landscaper, and I have an appointment with him tomorrow morning, and I'm going to go over some paperwork that he needs to do for his certificates of compliance, and I'm going to direct the landscaper on how much we need to pull out of there, because at some point it's going to become
right.
damage. So all that's happening, and he should be back at our meeting on the 27th, which the family and the attorney feel is in plenty of time to meet the requirements of the closing.
It's too late, but those were two huge trees that were cut down in the buffer. Did you see them?
Right.
There
yes.
was, there was
yes.
sawdust
was
on the
not,
ground. I mean, that was
that
like
wasn't
a few days old.
No, we saw that.
Yeah. Did you mention that to him, Chuck?
I didn't get any direction on that, Al. Did you?
Actually,
I can't.
So
I'm meeting with him
tomorrow.
Could
someone enlighten me? So I drove by the site, but I unfortunately, I was...
So to the right of the property...
Wait a minute.
Meandering all along
yeah, so
the wetland.
Yeah, I saw like where the wetland was. These two, right? Okay.
Cut trees and within 10 or 15 feet of the whole wetland line is leaf, sand, branch, fell up to 2 feet plus...
Knee-deep.
Yeah.
It's a mess.
So there's been a lot of filling in here, and there's been trees cut without permits.
Two large trees.
I don't think they were in the wetland.
They're
in the buffer, definitely.
So
that they were, but I don't think that the limbs or the trunks of those trees were in there, because I didn't see anything real recent.
But so should we...
There were some big logs thrown
there
further
were,
back.
But wasn't those
trees.
No?
No.
Uh-huh. Should there be a replacement for...
Yes, we had talked about a couple tree replacements.
So look on the screen right now. Here we're looking at 2008, and here's the driveway.
Yeah, right there where you are.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll go back a little bit further.
This new one has street view too, doesn't it?
98, I don't know if that one. Well, I'm not on Google yet, so I'll go there next. So.
I thought the, doesn't matter. Our GIS even has that, or the new.
Sounds like we're all.
Well, it has this, but look at that picture. That's, I actually have it here. It's not, it's not good.
Plant some trees and clean up and come back.
But isn't the house on the market?
It is.
So, so.
That's why they want the certificate of compliance. They need that.
Before you jump on, before you jump, you need, so if you wanna go down the tree alley, you wanna go down that road, you just can't assume that they were healthy. So you have to give them the opportunity to say, what happened here? What was the reason? And if he says, look, they were, these were diseased or damaged trees, he may have some sort of bill of lading or something like that with something on them. And you know, for those type of trees, we usually don't ask for a replacement. So there's a process. So I'll try to discover that tomorrow.
Just disagree to the extent that whether they were damaged or not, he still needed to come to us first.
Mm-hmm. Well, right. That's just, that's, well, that has nothing to do with what ends up happening. What ends up happening is even if before or after, when they get here, if it's a damaged tree, we haven't been, we've never said replace it. If it's dead or
well, if you can bring the tree in and show us it's damaged.
Well, that's why I said the bill of lading. So
they
maybe
were,
it has a description on it.
Chuck, there were, did you see the stumps?
Yes, we saw.
There were
a
good 18, 20 inches in diameter, and they didn't look like they were rotten in the middle.
Just presenting the other side because
know,
the applicant's not here.
That's usually my job.
All right.
See, but hang around me too much.
Come on.
Let's move on.
Yeah, talk to him. That's fine. But find, you know, find out what's
Cedar
going on.
Cedar Swamp, northeast boundary of Reading. It's continued at the request of the applicant.
Yeah.
And the next three, Mariano Drive.
Chuck, if you're going to meet somebody else at 9 tomorrow, I thought I heard you say, if you can, I'm going to have somebody in Mariano tomorrow. I walked it today and flagged a whole bunch of stuff to be pulled out of there. So if you went by there at like 11 or 12, you could talk to that person and look it over and
so, I don't know
do.
If I should pretend you should be over there,
I'm
or
sorry.
Maybe you want
I'm
to be
sorry.
Over there.
I'm sorry, should I recuse myself? I'm going
to
recuse
because I have
myself.
Something to say. And
just
so
to talk
you,
to Mariano, I'll recuse
okay.
myself.
So, I just want to remind you that the commission asked you to have them out there and for me to direct them what to do and then for me to show up before they left to make sure they did the extent so it wouldn't cost you two times for them to go out.
So consider tomorrow telling them what to do.
Okay.
That's fine.
And show up around, what, 10? 10 or 11?
10 or 11 would be fine.
Okay.
Yep. He's going to be puttering around out there.
And if it's not correct, they'll come back another day, or?
He'll come back 5 days if you want to. Doesn't matter. I'll keep doing it till it's what you want.
We got all that.
Yeah, you heard it here.
Speak up a little.
Yeah, just wait.
Actually, my son works for me. He was away for a month, so he came back.
No, I know. I just wanted to make sure that we're not trying to like.
I know.
You know, it was supposed. I'm supposed to check it and say it's done, and then it's on me.
Yeah.
Okay.
What is it? New construction that just needs to be cleared now?
No, one of the conditions we asked Al to do, and Al also offered it during his presentation when he was doing this subdivision, was the fact that he would take some material, some debris out of the wetland area by hand or whatnot, and that hasn't been done yet. So when he tried to get his order of conditions, there were several things needed, but and that was one of them, and we were just trying to, we were wrestling with how that would happen, and that seemed, what we decided and just talked about seemed to be the best way to do it. So, this is off Sanborn Lane.
Oh, yeah,
it's
yeah.
a new development called
Mariano.
Yeah. You always name him after somebody and that's owner?
I like to name him after my kids and stuff like that, but I haven't had the opportunity. That's the previous owner's name.
Yeah.
That's why, same thing with Bethune. Bethune was the previous owner's name. You know any of the Bethunes from? There's a large family, and they were in town for 20 or 30 years, and that guy was. I'd actually named it something else, and he was adamant. He
God's
sakes.
Make a check? He's going nuts.
No, I just found the tree.
Oh, you found the tree that he cut down?
Yeah, so everybody, all right, hold your breath.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. No, there is one.
It was behind it.
It's behind that one. That's still there.
Mm.
If you could just.
Well, there are three all together?
Three. Yeah, one, two, three. That one's a 15 inch. The
see
other
it right
two
there?
Are 10 inches.
Right there, there.
They are.
Wow.
Yep.
Yeah, nice and shady that vernal pool was.
There they are.
Yeah.
And here.
Wait, so which ones are gone? Which ones
I'm
are
actually.
This one here.
I'm actually.
And this larger one is
yeah,
still here.
It's still there.
Okay.
Correct.
That really big one's there, but there's those
okay.
two, and then is there another one a little further to the left?
Thanks.
I didn't see one.
You didn't? Okay.
I saw two.
So I thought
stumps.
I saw two that were very close together.
There were two stumps.
Two stumps. Mm.
Yeah.
Is the.
I did notice on
oh,
the
wait,
granite.
I just want to see that filled in again. One of these days. 29.
Yeah, that's right there.
Holy.
An aerial
right.
view does a lot better for that. But anyways, there's
yeah.
the trees.
They're the one of us.
And
yeah.
I you know, I would say
the granite blocks.
Right.
Yeah.
See what it was?
That this was
well,
done
did
in
you see what it was?
No, I didn't.
Chuck, do me a favor, just go back to 29. Gavin? Those just the wetland area that got cut?
I don't know. You know, I'm not the greatest
the right?
at this, I guess.
No,
you,
and then you went past
think
it. It's right
just,
there.
I don't think
just
you,
to the left.
Yeah, you
just
all
just
that.
Click and drag.
Yeah. This thing here?
Yeah,
no.
Just
grab
the
middle
of
the screen. And turn
really?
It. Yep.
Oh, my.
Look at that.
To the left, all that.
Look at that.
All
wow.
that.
Thank you there, Carrie.
All of that got cut and filled. Anyway, that was then.
But this is what we're, these two trees are what we're here for. So.
Okay. 18 Beaver Road, Point Well.
Yeah, that was just a minor project permit. It was for point-driven well. You know, 25 to 35 foot deep, and this was approved
okay.
as a minor project permit.
400 Main Street.
Amy, you want to talk about it?
Oh my God, that was horrible.
Where's this?
So it's a
site
what
building.
Is it? It's a
it is a commercial
building.
That,
like two units,
yeah.
Yeah, that the person cleared the land in the back without telling anybody. It's just a little diagonal triangle that abuts a stream. I don't know.
Yeah, it's a channelized
channel
stream.
Water.
Yeah, channelized stream is.
Can we bring it up on the.
It's.
What are we talking? Can you just tell what are we
yeah.
talking about?
It's where the cleaner. It's where
it's
that Mary Maid's
building
is.
Used to be.
So is this
right
a
near.
Possible unauthorized activity? Is that
yes,
what we're talking about? Okay. Just
it
didn't
cut.
Know where we were. Okay.
It's a channelized swale. It's got running water and it's.
Is it 400 Main Street?
Is it on the? Is
oh, is this the new
it's
the
right
thing
across
that looks like a house?
Yeah, I'm trying
yeah.
to visualize it as
right
on
next to the car wash.
Yeah,
well, I think that's
yeah.
a real estate office, right?
No,
on the other side of that. It looks like now that so this is a newer. It look the, are they fixed? They just fixed
it
up. It
looks a little
and,
bit renovated, but
yeah.
No.
Am I talking about different place?
No, it's
all right. So when I come home on the train at night, there's a channel on my right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Behind
yes,
the
right
train and the apartment buildings. Is that the channel,
no.
or is it on the other
yes.
side?
Yeah.
Okay. You know where the
yes.
Car wash is?
Yeah.
That's on your left.
Yeah.
This is right on your right.
Yeah. Okay. I know
street.
What you're talking about.
Yeah.
So.
Well, if you're facing forward.
Yes.
If you're facing backwards.
Half my life. So
he cleaned out brush and there is there's still a standing tree that's in really bad. It has no bark on it. I mean, it's kind of dead.
So where's the resource?
But he needed to obviously.
Sorry, I get to turn.
Oh, is this a little building where
it's
you put one garage
yes.
under and there's a
yes.
Oh, it was for sale.
Yeah.
Now it's rent. All right,
yes.
I know where you are.
Next, maybe next to the glass company, Ocean Glass.
No.
Save the street, but that's on the other side.
So there we are. All
right.
So
yeah.
Yeah.
that's the front, you know, so we're not gonna see too much from that. I'm glad I did that.
No, you can't get back.
I don't know if it's like
So this gentleman was upstairs and he pounded on the door, no response. Window was open and Chuck yelled, "Hey!" And he came down.
Yeah, I think that they, how do I get back to this? Where's this going
to
take me?
Basically, Chuck told him to come in and talk to him, and, you know, there's a permit that you have to file. He's a new owner, and he's kind of renovating things. And he also is doing some work without, you know, probably a building permit as well, so he told him about the building permit.
Okay.
So the owner and his son, or the two owners, son, dad and son, came in today and talked to me,
mm-hmm.
and they said...
where's the resource area?
Yep.
The channel.
There you go, right there.
Streams.
See the blue?
Okay.
And is that a intermittent stream, or is that...
That's a channel with an armored bank.
Yeah, I know what it is.
Yeah.
Beautiful piece
that's
of
definitely an intermittent stream.
It's what?
Intermittent. You're being recorded.
Well,
it's an intermittent stream. So you know, it's a challenged piece of property, and it's been on the market for a long time, and these two people have bought it. And what was in the back, because I looked just about with every single realtor that came down and wanted to sell it, was there was some trees that had, like, you know, 4-inch DBH and a little bit bigger. Some were right up against the fence, which is a chain link fence, and some of them were in this. So this is the only area we're talking about right here. So some were in the center, but there was all this brush also, really tiny stuff that was grown up amongst all this. These two guys just cut down some of the trees that were close to the fence or overhanging the other sidewalk,
parking
area, and they cut out the brush and they piled it up there, and that was the extent of what they did. They will leave everything else that's there, and they have no intention of doing any more work out there other than raking it out and throwing down some grass seed. So they want to know, for that, what the commission thinks that they need to do, that they need to file a permit to remove that brush and then cut down those trees that were, you know, scattered. They're probably a little bit scattered, but I remember them pretty much up against the chain link fence.
Mm-hmm.
So is the bank? That armored bank, is that solid?
Yeah.
Not in danger of tipping over or anything?
No, it's not. And I don't even, it's not even their responsibility, I don't think, to repair.
No.
So,
that would be the town. Yeah.
But it's flush with the ground, or pretty close to, there's probably a little bit of a lip there. They first came in and they said, well, we want to do like a picnic area out there, and we want to maybe put down some stone and maybe do some planting. And then, after kind of considering it, they thought that would cost more money than they wanted to spend on this area right now. So for right now, it's a question mark. They may do something later, but for right now, it's pretty much what they've done what they're going to do. And especially with the warning they got from the very gentle and quiet administrator.
So
that rousted him out of their, you know, lofty
actually,
house.
I think we had talked about the gravel, and I think you're right. The gravel might end up in that channel,
mm-hmm.
but the grass actually will act a little bit as a filter.
Right.
You know?
I don't know how much was... There was not any grass that I ever remember being out there. There might have been a little bit, but it's shaded. So has the canopy,
it's really
you know, it's a tough
Difficult.
Difficult.
It's a hardy area. It's about as, it's about almost as close to urban as Reading gets, that little, right? That little chunk right there. But at the same time, if we can, I mean, I'm not, clearly wants to do probably a low-cost fix for that area. But if we can encourage him to even put like one native in there, you know, I think we'd be remiss to not at least mention
it.
No, there are some plants that are hardy.
Is it still shady with the trees that remain?
I think it is. Yeah, I would say it's going to be. It's likely, but I don't know, more likely than not, that you can't finish a property and not do something with the back.
Yeah, no, I get it.
What's the intention of him renting it to whom?
It has to be office space, so it's commercial.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be, if that was me, I would think maybe a picnic table out there, like they were talking about that, so someone could go out and, you know. I think my biggest concern with the site is.
Watch the train while you eat lunch? Watch
anything
your sandwich
is an improvement.
Yes.
Over what it is.
Yeah.
Right.
And I kind of hate, you know, it looks like a minor project permit, or an RDA, and that's, you know, that's money he could be spending on plants.
I think I see where you're going. I'm kind of the same. I don't know that I see this as, you know, this isn't a big concern. You know, it sounds like he wasn't aware prior to this that, you know, he had to pay attention to what was going on.
It's hard to get exercised over this huge property. I mean, I
absolutely.
Like every little spot
no,
that,
absolutely.
That looks like something's going on there.
There's no salamanders on that site.
Well, they're wearing construction hats if there are.
No, there could be birds.
They're hardy. There's definitely birds. There's squirrels.
Rodents.
Yeah, there's some rodents, probably.
And they cut down a couple of trees, you said? I mean, they could plant one tree in the back corner. But maybe not, I mean, maybe not right now because the roots are still, you know, haven't degraded enough so that there is a spot in the soil to plant. I just, you know, as much as I see their restriction, I just sort of think you could throw like even one or two little small, cheap natives in there.
So I see what you're saying. The only thing I think I would say with how
something
I haven't
vines,
seen it, but what it sounds like the condition that it was in, I think whatever clearing they may have done may have even give whatever's left out there.
Could have removed some invasives.
Yes.
Yes.
So
absolutely.
More opportunity
and
for that to what's out there.
The beginning
to
of
survive.
Improvement.
Yeah.
There was probably some vines.
But
mm-hmm.
technically speaking, it was a violation. It was cutting of vegetation within.
Technically, yeah.
But another way to look at it, though, I mean,
Well, was it a violation? I'm not sure. I mean, was
because
it maintenance? I didn't mean to agree with you. I wasn't listening. I'm sorry. But then I caught back up, and I want you to know that, hey, is it maintenance, which is allowed, and we don't want to prevent anyone from doing maintenance on their property, right? So that's why I told you it was up against the chain link fence, and the other stuff was brush.
Mm-hmm.
This thing, if it was a wetland, it wouldn't even be jurisdictional.
Right.
But it's
less than 500 square feet.
It's
hardly 400 square feet. Can you see that up there?
So why is it jurisdiction?
So none of it's
so it's
bank
not jurisdiction.
Well,
it's
we don't do it like that.
Yeah.
That's I was mixing and matching.
Oh yeah, no, I know.
It's adjacent to the bank.
It's adjacent to the bank. So the
okay.
bank would bank.
Even though the bank
but it's
is.
Intermittent.
So what
is
intermittent has bank. Which is jurisdiction on
it's
either side.
It's still land
not
underwater,
just not
which
under
is still jurisdiction.
Just not
as
under jurisdiction.
Reprimanded by
so you know what I'd love
Dick.
To see? Maybe we can't. The problem I see with that is the stream itself. And that's what I was talking about being a mess. And I followed the stream from One General Way up to along the parking lot behind K&G up to where it comes out from under
28 near here.
Yeah, the Rite Aid, the
which is near
McDonald's,
here. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's a disgusting mess back there.
It is.
And
it's not good habitat.
That section, I'm sure there's all kinds of trash in it and stuff.
Right.
I mean, fix some of that up.
Yeah, I wouldn't say put a picnic bench there because whoever's eating is gonna throw their.
Yeah, it's true, but yeah, it's a great spot for a picnic fence.
It is.
So what would be an improvement? Yeah. I don't know if I would send him into the stream to clean it up. It's got that armored bank, and I don't even know if that's a natural bottom, if it's concrete.
I'm sure it's concrete.
Is that, and that's not on their property?
What if there was some, I mean, there's existing fence between that portion of yard, that portion and the stream, right? Is existing chain?
No, the street, the fence is up against the parking area.
No, it's, oh, there's nothing between that triangle and the intermittent stream.
No.
If you were walking there at night.
Farther.
You'd walk right into that stream, there's nothing. There's maybe a little tiny lip.
Of concrete?
Yeah.
And then concrete top of the wall.
And then you're down, what, 3-4 feet?
Yeah, you break your legs.
Okay, so.
I really think these guys are just trying to.
They're just trying to fix it up.
They're trying to fix it up, they're trying to stay within, you know, they're doing one thing at a time, that's for sure. And this might be something they attack later, and I think they get the rules now. I think there's way too many trees on this site already to plant any more. And if I was thinking of what would be a great improvement, would be some sort of barrier to prevent the dirt and whatnot from falling into the stream. That would be great, but I don't know what that would be, and I don't know what these guys would propose.
Like
so,
even proposing putting some sort of chain link fence along that, or low fence.
Well, no, by barrier you mean like some grass in between, something, some sort of.
Yeah, you could do like,
wildflower.
I was thinking
wildflower.
Of vegetation, or just going with the cement theme, you could just bring that up a bit and, you know,
make a raised wall.
I guess I'm keyed into like their you know, I don't know, their Yankee-ness work ethic, you know, the fact that they don't want to spend money and they'd rather find and create things. And so I'm thinking if, I don't know what they would come up with, but when we talked about planting, they had a long discussion about how much plants would cost. They were happy to leave it where it is right now and buy a bag of seed and rake it out and see if anything grows. And if nothing grows and they are confronted with a dirt area back there, and you know, someone else wants to do something about it, then the next owner or a tenant, then that's great.
Does the existing site slope towards the bank?
It's pretty level.
It's
yeah,
flat.
And the,
it's really flat.
And the armored banking, it's up about 2 inches, 2.5 inches, 3 inches. So it would take a lot to go over it. And it did look kind of clean in their general area too. I saw a stone, but
you know, maybe the benefit at this point is having a property owner that's interested in having that be a slightly better quality space. You know, and as long as the communication is open and they know they need to come in if they want to do anything more, you know, maybe there's something down the road when they've got more resources.
Yeah.
That sounds, that's about as pragmatic
yeah.
as I get.
Yeah,
on
that's
this
one.
Pretty pragmatic.
I think,
yeah, I agree.
I don't. Just
it's just something we'll have to keep an eye on. I'm not promising
we're aware.
I know these people or anything like that. They're aware of it. They're willing to stop. I don't know what's going to happen in the future.
What if you sent them a letter saying, don't cut anything else down without permission approval, just so we have a record?
I should send them a letter, yeah, anyways.
And
so,
then
that's a good idea.
Then you got a letter, you know, they
something on the record.
Yeah.
We told them not to cut anything else down. Then if they do something that we really disapprove of, we can point back to that.
I agree with that.
That's
I think
a
that's
very good
a good
idea.
Idea.
Yeah.
Okay.
Short, easy letter. Administrator's report, Abadjana River site.
Well, yeah, I think we got that.
Covered that.
Yeah.
A lot.
Emergency permits? No. Any bills? Ooh. MACC.
Yeah, it seems like somebody, it's like this lost soul that went down there, signed up at the last minute. They were rustling around and they were like, think they sent this bill to other communities first and then we got it. But I recognize the name. One
Me?
One Harry Curtis.
Oh.
Yeah. So I don't know what happened, but yeah, it just came in.
Oh.
And so I told him, you know, he's on our commission.
I told him that too.
We'll pay.
I move we approve the bill.
So yeah.
I'll second.
Those in favor?
Probably should abstain, so that it's coming out of my pocket.
I think
you can
approve.
Did everyone read the minutes for the 23rd of March?
I think I don't think I did. I think Jamie's name was just spelled wrong and it one spot.
Mm-hmm. Did you have some comments?
No comments.
What?
Don't you mean yes, kind sir, or something like that?
What?
Is this an opportunity for me to get this thing printed out so you guys can sign it while you're talking about
yeah,
the minutes?
Go ahead,
yeah.
Yeah, go ahead and
yes,
change
yeah,
that.
Sure.
I'm glad you remembered. Smarter than. Yeah, I wouldn't. Already forgot.
Okay.
Oh, thanks.
I make a motion to approve the minutes.
I'll second. Those in favor? Anika, do you have an update on the tree policy?
I sent out an email. The only place we're at right now is trying to organize the next meeting, and got a variety of responses back. People who can make it either by phone or in person or
is it,
can't make it.
Is phone an option?
We can make it an option. We can make it an option.
Because I could try that if you pick a date.
Sure. Sure.
But it's sort of iffy.
I mean, we've got a speakerphone here. I'd look, you know, those dates were picked so that it would be a town hall.
Okay.
So yeah, can do that.
And do you have are we starting with someone else's or do we have?
We're starting with someone else's.
Okay. All right.
I'll either forward it to you, or if you'd like, I could take a stab at drafting a beginning.
Start with whatever they did. If we could
okay.
just change the name, that would be great.
Well, could we just send it along again? So Chuck had sent...
With whatever, who did?
Chuck forwarded... So how this started a number of months ago is Chuck forwarded information to me, at least, and I don't know if it went out to you or not.
Yeah, I read it.
But there was a couple of attachments. Starting place... Paperwork from Lexington, and I can forward it.
I don't think we should do what Lexington did and change the name.
We'll start somewhere.
Yeah, just start with somebody's, and then you give your roadmap.
And
take out what you want to take out, add what you want to add.
Right.
Since that was sent, I think so. We've got. I don't think you were on the commission when that was sent, so maybe we just want to recirculate that.
Okay.
Okay. I want to bring up another topic, site visits. Now that it's getting light out, I know that we've had these two time slots, and I'd like to kind of open it up and see if there's any possibility of doing it on maybe a Tuesday night.
What time?
What time did we usually start?
I think it was six. I think it was six.
Six? Who couldn't do Tuesday night?
Well, so I thought the problem with Tuesday night was that it doesn't give us a whole lot of time to put together our field notes and send it around. I thought that was the only thing otherwise.
And I'm not sure about Jamie. Was it? I can't remember if it was Monday or Tuesday.
Jamie's
Monday
night
okay.
was his class, but I think that ends in May.
I'm not too keen about going out at 6 o'clock at night in the summer.
Well, that's how we usually did it anyways.
Well, it is.
I'm good with it.
Because we have some folks that are, you're coming in from town, and you're coming in from Burlington.
Waltham.
Mm-hmm. Close.
A little further.
But Tuesday night for me is sort of, like I have to leave early to get here by 6. I usually leave, but I usually get home at 7.
Well, we might still be at on site visits.
Well, as long as you have everybody's phone number, couldn't you meet potentially?
Well, I missed the first one or two.
Yeah.
If we go beyond, if we start at 7, we won't be able to see most of them. It'll get too dark. And Chuck's available to do this because he's here till 7 on Tuesdays, right?
I am here till 7. So
is that going to be a conflict with office time or no?
It is kind of a conflict, but I did talk to Julie Mincier, who said that it would be okay. I don't know if it's going to be okay from now on, but for the upcoming couple, it would probably be okay. We'll just evaluate it as it goes forward. But
let's go back
I'm willing to try it.
Why does Monday work? Did I get a chance to ask you that?
I think Jamie.
Yeah, but it was Jamie, and doesn't his...
Jamie can't go at 3 o'clock in the afternoon.
They finish up May 7th. That's the last final.
Oh, yeah, same.
My son is there.
Same school.
Well, that's just like two.
So
two
one more, one more commission,
yeah.
One more meeting, one more site visit.
Six any night of the week is going to be the same for me. So Monday, Tuesday,
right.
Doesn't really matter. I'll do my best to make it work.
All right.
Who has to be at 6? Do you have to be at 6 too? Maybe?
Well, I prefer to.
I'd rather do it in the afternoon at 3 or 4.
Some of us aren't our own boss.
Yeah. Well,
in fact, Tuesday is probably better than Monday for me, honestly.
All right. It doesn't matter
either
for you. It
doesn't matter on Monday
or
Tuesday.
Don't, no weekends? So it's not going to work for me if you do it 6 o'clock on Monday night. So that would be...
Right.
Okay.
That's not going to work for you on a weekend.
No.
So
well, let's go. Well, what
I
do we
like you guys,
Tuesday?
But that's not going to work.
Tuesday at 6?
Do I get five?
What about, so then the other option is just to keep it the same. I mean, you could just do 2.
I think 2 is confusing. Because of, well, you know, Mr. Erickson could meet you on the Monday afternoon, and we didn't get that interaction and knowledge on the Sunday morning visits, you know, and I just think for consistency. It wouldn't have made a difference.
Yeah,
no.
That was for me and him to meet, and then
I showed up.
It was hijacked
by
chair.
But there are times that we have the consultant at the site. The consultant
mm-hmm.
is at the site.
Right.
And it would only be.
Yeah.
One of the two.
I guess the consultants come out on Sunday, but they prefer to do it on Monday
Steve
through Friday.
Steve and
Maureen,
is it, what? Didn't they come out on that Main Street project?
They've been there on Sundays,
yeah.
You guys.
Yeah. The artists?
No,
property?
It's the other one. The other side. Further towards North Reading.
I don't mind Sunday mornings as well.
I actually like Sunday mornings.
Yeah, me too.
Especially if I get to put my boots on and go walk around in a river.
You can't do Sunday.
No, I can't.
And I know for the summer, I know it's.
But you can do Monday.
I can do Monday night.
So let's keep it split up. We'll keep it Sunday morning and Monday night.
Until Jamie's out of the class.
Well, I don't think even this has nothing. The decision had nothing to do with Jamie. It's because Amy can't do it on Sundays.
Right.
That won't change when Jamie doesn't
okay.
have a class
right.
anymore.
Right. But instead of Monday afternoons, it could be Tuesday night. It could be Sunday morning, Tuesday night.
Yeah.
Right.
But 6 o'clock tonight, we did 2.5 hours.
Well, maybe we could.
That's motivation to go a little faster.
Well, what if the people who can show up on Sunday morning do like half, the first half of site visits, and the people who are out.
Actually, I kind of like the feedback from the two groups. I thought that it was
see
two different perspectives.
Social experiment.
You could
actually, we're kind of pretty much on the same page. We saw the same thing at Gavin Circle.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
that was pretty obvious, though.
Yeah.
That was an obvious
well,
one.
you'd think so sometimes, but.
We went to look at the porch.
Yeah.
I don't know. So we have Sunday at 9:00, and then what, Tuesday at?
Six.
Six?
Four.
Well, you're gonna go on Sunday.
Well, yeah.
So.
And Al's gonna go on Sunday, and Anika's gonna go on Sunday, but it's, so it's Mike, Amy, and what time is the earliest you can go?
Six.
You can go at 6:00 on Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
Alright, so that would, I would only be there for an hour, which is fine.
And by Tuesday, you'll know what sites we couldn't get to. If there's any, we couldn't, you know, I don't know, I doubt it though, I mean, we start at 9:00, usually go until it's over. There's plenty of daylight, so.
Okay.
So maybe we would just pick the, well, with me, it doesn't matter, we can just do what you think is important, and then I can hit the rest on my own town time.
And we'll keep it split up, if we get a large agenda, I like Anika's idea. You know, no one wants to spend 4 hours on a Tuesday night or a Sunday morning. If there's, you know, 8 site visits or 9 site visits, maybe we'll split them up. Tuesday people will get 5 and Sunday people will get 4.
Yeah, and there's another thing we have done is if, well, when there's only one site visit and there's a huge list, is maybe, you know, three members do the first half of the site visits and the other three members do the second half of the site visits, and everybody just goes off in 2 carpools. So it's literally killing 2 birds with 1 stone there. That's another option.
Okay,
but
so Sunday at 9:00 and Tuesday at 6:00.
Okay, sounds good.
Can I ask one question? Just my education. So when we went to see Rustic Lane, which was the porch converted to addition. And that's an RDA, right?
No, it's
yours.
That's why they're filing for
RDA.
RDA.
Rustic Lane. So that was the one with the flags right at the stone wall.
Oh, that's
way in the back.
That's
and
not
the
rustic.
Grass.
That wasn't rustic, was it?
Yeah.
So what did they do with draw check? Why were they in the gym?
We didn't go to rustic because they continued.
Continued.
Why did they continue?
Because they couldn't be at the meeting.
Okay.
And Jack couldn't be here either. Jack,
so
didn't Steve
it.
Flag that?
Steve did flag it, but he's not leading that project. Jack Sullivan is.
Okay.
So my only question is trying to understand how to assess whether those flags are in the right place. Within probably 15 feet of the stone wall in the lawn, street, an inch or two of standing water in some pockets. So how do we assess whether the flags are in the right place when it's a lawn? I mean, did they do any soil tests or?
Well, you can still auger
that's,
down.
Yep,
that's been done before. I've seen that done. I've seen some grassy lawns flagged as wetlands.
I mean, it's hard to say because of the time of year, right? Maybe it's too wet because of the
rain.
Well,
yes and no. It is the high water table time of year. This is the seasonal wet time of year. So
I'm not going to put it up because the applicant's not here.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to keep your questions pretty general because we're not giving them an opportunity to. Maybe if you talk about another site.
So my question in general is when you go to a property that has a lawn that is very, very wet, how do we assess?
Well, that's resource area. It's
well,
just soils.
You would look at the area that is natural.
Yeah.
Okay. And I would take a soil core in that area to see if I had any redoxy morphological features. Then I'd walk up to that other area and see if there were
the same
type of redoxy morphological features.
Well, you could look at the grasses too, just tell them not to mow for a couple of weeks and see what comes up.
And he said.
So that's very close, yeah. In general, it could be very closely mowed. So
So who does the auger or the soil test? Is that something you do?
Well,
I don't know how to do that.
So typically,
it's not on my banker resume.
I mean, if we have a question, we ask. We ask, like Steve Erickson, can you prove that this isn't, wetland, and what are you doing to, how do you prove that to us? Show us in.
Okay.
That would be best to, if you went out there on Sunday and you noticed that there was, you were questioning the wetland line, it'd be great to get that back to me, because Steve would want to go out there and we could look at.
So that was in my notes, but it might not have been clear enough.
Yeah, we could look at that, because Steve needs to be there. So we're verifying his wetland line.
Yeah.
If you have a question, you say, I need, all right, I just need you to prove it. I want to see some soil samples.
Okay.
We could do that on a Monday.
Okay.
We could do that on a Tuesday, anytime before the meeting. But, you know, you want to give this guy an opportunity to close on at the meeting.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Right, and then you could be there too, but it doesn't, we just talked about everyone's time and it doesn't seem like that works.
Okay. So, you want me to send you an email to that effect?
Oh, over here? Yeah, sure.
Okay.
All right.
And then I need the combination to enter a cabin.
Okay.
So I'm going to take pictures so that we can.
Did I even send that to you?
No.
Chuck.
Well,
you could just write it down,
you
Harry.
Want.
You could just write
it's
it down.
It's not right on there.
Wait,
look at that.
What's this?
Changing that. I
the,
hope that's
the
still
sticky.
The same one.
Well, yeah. Tell me if it's not, but.
Oh.
Ta-da.
If there's something up, is there anything else? I just wanted to mention a couple things I saw in the newspaper. All right. Friends and Family Day is coming up in June. It's June 11th, and I know that seems far away, but it's probably going to show up fast. We generally have a table there and ask for volunteers to man it, and it's a good chance to get some interaction with the public.
Is that Father's Day weekend?
It might be.
Is that like Town Day?
Friends and Family Day, yeah.
Okay.
So it's set up in
close off Haven Street. And
it's
no,
not,
that's
it's not
the
Haven Street,
no,
it's at Birch
the
Meadow.
Oh, okay.
Opposite the Y.
Yeah.
That whole area becomes kind of carnival booth world. So that's coming up. And for anybody interested, I saw a little notice about early Sunday morning bird watching opportunities by a local bird expert. So
who's that?
Dave Williams.
Where?
Town Forest, April 24, starting at 6:30. These are all 6:30 to 8:30 on Sunday mornings. Bear Meadow, Town Forest, near Stroud Ave.
I could add it to the site visit list for the Sunday morning people.
Yeah, for people to start at 6:30. There's a Mother's Day walk. There's
it's required, Al.
Yeah. There's going to be a test.
My Pelican.
It looks like there, I mean, at a variety of places on Stroud Ave, Lobb's Pound. So, variety of places.
So, to go back, do we usually register for a booth?
Yeah, we usually do.
Are we going to?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, usually do. Mm-hmm. We did last year.
Do you want the?
No one's asking me. I was just.
So.
Yes, 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 and yes, and we stay there all day. And usually, Will brings his turtle, and.
Please don't.
And there's, and people get worried about the poor turtle. What's that?
This is just contact information to get to just.
Thank you.
Coordinate.
But I work for the town, and we've done this. We already
have
our application
have
in.
Yeah.
No, we already
so
have an application. I guess that's
like
what I'm
neighbor or something.
I guess that's
like
what
that.
I'm asking is we already have applied for a booth, and we're all set.
Thank you, though.
Well,
good job, Chuck.
You know, I just feel like if you bring your little stuff here, you want to talk about it. I'm not. Who am I to stop you?
No, I'm done.
Any other business? Okay, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor? Good job, Eric.